This is a presentation that Chris Weeks from NICRAC originally put together. I'm not a big fan of reinventing the wheel. So he and I are good friends. He said, use it, change it to fit your needs for what we have to do today. So I left a lot of his plaudits there, I guess you would say, so he gets credit. So we're going to talk a little bit about initially with opportunities, challenges, and needs of aquaculture in the North Central region, NICRAC, NCR, and Ohio. We are one of the 12 states in that region. And we're going to talk about opportunities first. Look what global aquaculture has done in terms of sales and volume and what they're forecasting it to go to 2019. So in 2012, the value in U.S. dollars was $135 billion worldwide. And they're forecasting by 2019, it's going to be $195 billion. So there's a lot of demand for aquaculture products, aquatically cultured products. I shouldn't say just aquaculture, but that could be aquaponics, other things. And in 2030, up to $330 billion. And you can see here on the graph, if you look at just look at the purple, the dark purple here is the capture fisheries, which means wild caught, whether it be Lake Erie or Atlantic Ocean or the deadliest catch off Alaska if you've watched that show. And here's aquaculture. So there's no forecast, they're not forecasting any growth in capture fisheries. And those of you that have an biology background, like myself, or keep up with this stuff, we always used to think the oceans were the unlimited bounty. Most of our species now have been hit pretty hard harvest-wise, and many of them are actually being over-harvested worldwide. So aquaculture has been projected as to pick that slack up. So if you look at the relative ratio of farm-raised to wild-caught, right in 2012, which is now 4 years ago, it was about half and half between capture fisheries and aquaculture. By 2030, which is only 14 years away now, we'll be here before we know it, they're projecting that 62% will come from farm-raised facilities. Let's look at growth of population and meat supply. Our population worldwide is going up, probably going up rather alarmingly, to be honest with you. But the demand for meat supply has really gone up. Anybody hazard as to what countries are causing that big demand with the consumption of meat?
China.
China and then India would be next. China's got a very rapidly expanding middle class. And then not only do they man cars now and whatever, but they are moving into to meat consumption. A lot of anybody here raise pork? A lot of pork goes to China now. So protein. This is what we consume worldwide, pounds per person. Don't worry about wild farm fish. I want you to look at most of them, whether it be pork, beef, are fairly level. Farm-raised fish and poultry are the two that are going up worldwide. So if you can figure out a way to grow your chickens with your fish, you have something there. But yeah, farm-raised fish are projected to be a major source of protein for the world's population in the next couple of decades. If you look at global aquaculture right now, this is just aquaculture. What is mariculture? Anybody know? By the way, I'm an extension retiree. I'm going to ask questions. It's just the way it's going to be. But what is mariculture? The clue's right up there in front of you.
Ocean.
Yep, not inland. It's in the ocean, shallow bays, estuaries, things like that. But notice that 67% of the global production from inland areas is freshwater systems. So, you know, you got Chesapeake Bay there, which is classified as an inland, but it's, even though it's saltwater, but it's not a big producer. Sustainability. One of the things you look at is how many pounds of feed does it grow take to grow 1 pound of protein source? Look at the difference here. 6.8 pounds of feed to grow 1 pound of cattle. And you go all the way down here to fish. Pretty efficient. Now, not every species is 1-to-1. Some of them are different, but on average, it's 1-to-1. Anybody care to, what's that mean for the environment?
Takes on more resources.
For, to the left, for cattle and stuff, yeah.
Land.
Yep. Exactly. Much more environmentally friendly on the aquaculture side of things, aquaponic sides of things. And in that vein, if you look at the phosphorus, nitrogen, and CO2 equivalents for these four critters in terms of what they take in and what they emit, I mean, just look at carbon dioxide in terms of growing them. That gets back to cattle, very high intensive CO2 and other fertilizers. Fish is relatively low for CO2 and nitrogen. Phosphorus is lower, but it's still significant. Keep in mind that what an animal takes in doesn't stay in the animal. Okay, it goes out. They don't keep everything they eat. So, you know, you manure problems. You all heard of Grand Lake, St. Mary's, and the cyanobacteria blooms, dangerous algae blooms. Okay, well, that's the cattle and what other thing, manure, and they're throwing it on the land. It's running off into the lake. So, you know, it's some of what they take in goes back out in fairly rapid order. My dad always used to say cattle were nothing but fart machines. And so they, you know, the methane they produce is fairly substantial out in that field. Opportunities. Let's look at some specialty products. Okay, I'm aquaculture, aquaponics in Ohio is not a commodity. In fact, I don't want to be involved if it's a commodity. What happens when something with commodities?
Prices, yep, go down.
Prices go down, you lose control. There's a whole bunch of things that, I don't want to say go wrong, but additional challenges when you're involved with a commodity. Right now, and I'm not even sure we're a niche market yet, to be honest with you. But at least, you know, if you grow good stuff, you find that niche market, you can command a higher price. So specialty products. Stuffed salmon with spinach feta. I've never heard of that before. So you get sustainable products. They waste less. Use everything. Believe it or not, there are people in Ohio that are raising fish that they make more money off the compost after cleaning than they do the fish. There it is. I'm not quite sure how Chris fades things in on occasion. So, certified products. I will say this with fish, it's going to be really tough to be organically certified. Okay, it's going to be really, really tough. Doesn't mean you can't use locally grown and support the local farm and all that as a selling point, but organic, they're working on it, but the problem with organic fish is they rely on fish feed, artificial diets. Where does that fish meal and fish oil come from right now? No, fish meal and fish oil is the bulk of it right now. So where's it coming from? It's coming from oceans. Okay, oceans, menhaden, anchovies. And in the oceans, there are enough pollutants running around that those fish are not clean. Now, they may be very low, but when you make feed, you can begin to accumulate a little bit. And so the United States government was to tell you that feed based on wild-caught fisheries is probably not going to be certified as organic feed. So the only way we're going to pull that off is to get fish to consume feeds that are made with soybeans, what have you, that can be grown organically. That's what's going to have to happen. And some species don't do well on that stuff. There's a lot of research on that. Go ahead.
But then when we start talking about fish eating various things, what about the whole concept of putting in to their diet what is naturally in their diet? I haven't seen a fish out farming yet, growing corn or soybeans. But yet that's the feed that we had. We have a lot in our tilapia and other farm raised.
You mean grains? Oh, yes. There's grains in trout diets. But the bulk of the trout diet, salmonid diet, is still fish meal and fish oil.
But when we start, we're learning a lot more about the microbiota nowadays, the bacteria that's in relationship with all organic, all mammals and higher life forms. So the microbiota is changed by the, and they do most of the digestion, but it's changed by the foods.
There is research along those lines right now, but we are a long way, in my opinion, from having almost all our species being able to get away from the oceans in terms of meal components.
But my point with that is we don't know what we're doing in that as far as creating allergy proteins.
Human health, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, the ultimate extension with that would be have fish feeds based on peanuts, with the peanut allergies running around. If that transferred over, I got a nephew that, my God, if he even looks at a peanut. So, you can have certified products, markets, opportunities. Folks, Ohio is centered pretty much where it needs to be to have access to a lot of the United States' big markets, with probably the exception being California. But you are within a day's drive to major U.S. markets. Now, I'm not advocating you look at Chicago and New York unless you have to, because I'll argue and I'll talk about it later. We got a monster market sitting right in here in Ohio that's untapped right now. But boy, we're within a day's drive if you like interstates. Market Maker, I just wanted to show this. How many of you are aware of Market Maker? It's a neat tool, boy. We probably need to show that. You probably will. Yeah. It is really a fun tool. I get on there and I can kill an hour without any stretch of the imagination. Now, when it first came out, you couldn't find a lot of fish on it, so I kind of said, I'm a tomato farmer, and used it as, where can I market my tomatoes I grew in my greenhouse? And it was amazing, the places that were popping up that I could get access to and contact information.
Did you get any deals? Did you get any deals from these contacts?
No, I was just playing with it. There's not much fish on it yet. There are some. Every time I looked, there's more and more. Christy, who manages Market Maker right now? Is that used to be...
It's back at the University of
Illinois. Illinois, okay. And what happens is each state that's a part of it has to pay there's a fee, annual fee. For those of you, and I'll just end with this before the break, for those of you that are going to go into aquaponics, the greenery side of your production, this would be a real asset, because you can go on there and type in microgreens or kale, and it's amazing what pops up out of Columbus, and I just gave you a clue as to one of my ace of spades for markets here later on, but definitely, you can go home now and play on it. I mean, you can find it real quick, so. With that, we'll take our break. That got me through the boring slides, and then we can get to the good stuff. 11 o'clock. Okay, so we left off with Market Maker. Again, by all means, at some point, learn how to use this. Oh, He continues on, Chris Weeks does with his things. So there's where he looked up and Clintonville Farmers Market popped up. That's what it does. So if you're looking for like Farmers Market, you type in and it'll show you where stuff is close to you. Okay, what are our challenges? What are the challenges facing us as an industry? Global competition. In terms of aquaculture, 87% of the production is by Asia. 56% of the production is by one country, China. Got cheap labor, availability of natural resources. I don't know what Chris meant by induced conditions for aquaculture. I'm going to have to ask him that. But look at, I mean, Asia is an overwhelming producer of farm-raised aquatic products. This is interesting. I've actually seen this. Not so much in here, but this is a bay, and people literally live on rafts next to their net pens. Okay, I actually saw a facility in China where the, I don't say hut, but the house had a series of ponds around it, and they were growing different kinds of carp. Okay, there was a carp that would eat the human stuff that came out. And it would cause a bloom that would go over into the next pond, and there would be a different carp that would be a planktivore. And then the next one around would be the planktivore that grew aquatic plants, and the grass carp, if you're familiar with grass carp. I mean, they literally completely have the whole cycle. But a floating city. Well, I would think that'd be dangerous with one tropical storm. But okay, y'all got to get this big. No, I'm just teasing. Catfish farming in the Mekong Delta, Vietnam. Look at all those ponds.
Those were mangroves at one time, too, right, Bill?
They do both rice and catfish. Basra, if you've heard. It's a major competitor for channel catfish fillets in the United States. So, and that's a good example. We had a major channel catfish industry down south, and it has considerably shrunk, and this is this global competition that's done it. Okay, and the channel catfish, when they're harvested down in the south, it's for the most part a frozen product. Well, that's what's coming from Vietnam too. Economics, challenges of economics. Some of you may have known this already. There's capital investment associated with anything you start. Stuff, money you got to spend to build your systems. So that's challenging. Because I'll be honest with you, and Chris Smalley, if he's still in the room, I don't know if he's here or not, but educating banks and lenders on aquaculture is a real challenge. We're not there yet with that. Most of them probably don't even know what it is, to be honest with you. Profit potential. Okay. This is a pet peeve of Chris Weeks, and one I agree with him on is, in terms of indoor systems, RAS, recirculating aquaculture systems, if you're familiar with that, and aquaponics, biologically we can do it. No problem. They do it down here at Piketon. We got other things. But the production costs of indoor systems are high. Okay, and when that becomes into play, the challenge becomes, can you make money with these indoor systems? Okay. And we got a lot of research going on in NICRAC that's looking at that on the aquaponics side. And we're starting to see some indications on the aquaponics side that we can. Okay. On RAS systems, I got serious concerns about.
Is that based on initial
It's annual operating budget, yeah. So you take out a portion of your depreciation cost annually and go down, but it's mostly on the operating.
What is that depreciated over, do you know?
Different things. My ponds, for example, I can only give them, are 20 years, although they're not going to disappear in 20 years. My seines, they give a five-year depreciation schedule on.
For indoor?
Oh, for indoor? Most of it's 20 years. And pond and cage culture production costs are a lot lower. Okay, it costs a lot less to grow a pound of yellow perch in a pond than it does in an indoor RAS system. In fact, the University of Wisconsin estimates are almost, unless you get absolutely huge, and I would argue that doesn't work anyway because Bell Aquaculture went down, they were a perch, almost $11 a pound to raise them. You can't do that profitably. So you got to tailor your goals with systems and species that will work. Economy of scale. Okay, I don't mean you have to get as big as the Mekong Delta, but can you picture buying feed for that huge of an operation? I mean, your discounts. You know, around here we always say you get a significant price discount when you buy a semi-truckload of feed at a time. That's true, because 3 years ago, everybody that was in our area of Ohio was doing that, and we banded together and got feed in by the truckload, and my feed cost went down 27% just by working with four other farms to buy feed. You need to be thinking about that. Even if it's dovetailing with our group or whatever, you need to, you can't be ordering 50-pound bags of feed at a time, okay? The freight cost is more than the feed. Okay, so Jenny Blackburn, who you will get to meet, I'm sure, Freshwater Harvest, okay, they're in aquaponics. They only need about 10, 15 bags of feed a year. They just tag on with us. They just come and get it when they need it from me, and I just charge them the price of what we paid for it. You need to do that. Otherwise, that's going to be a headache for you. An ability to compete in the fillet market with imports. Okay, imports are a real challenge. So you need to, if you're going to sell fillets to restaurants and high-end and specialty stores, you've got to have a marketing plan that highlights what you're providing. And I'm going to argue frozen for 6 months in a freezer ain't going to cut it. Here's just an example of a monster sturgeon in Abu Dhabi for caviar. Global versus national trends. Look at aquaculture production. The world is going up and the United States is going down.
Does that take into consideration the change from aquaculture to aquaponics?
No, aquaponics is so new that it hadn't shown up in the data yet. Okay. But that's a good point. But all the aquaponics facilities are small in terms of fish. So, but again, I mentioned this catfish industry that's what's causing most of this in the United States. Aquaculture production in the future, well, in the last, up to 2012, we've kind of stagnated, increased a little bit maybe, but the world is really taking the lead and moving forward.
Is it the economics of it or the weather conditions or why? Why are the catfish going down there?
Competition. Yep. I'll flat out say it. When the Vietnamese government, and it's free markets.
Right.
When the Basra became big, which is their version of a catfish, they started, we're the consumer. And they started shipping it here. Now, whether their government gave some unfair practices with shipping and stuff, I don't know. I mean, that's often the case with some of those governments. But
part of this, just to add to that, on the catfish side of things, for catfish, we're farming are finally getting a window to grow over $1 a pound.
Yes.
Products with much less quality, a lot of people here.
Yeah.
They're doing a lot better job testing a lot higher percentage of sugar than a lot.
Yeah.
Yep. It's coming in full of antibiotics,
yep,
and everything else is highly illegal here. It's coming in tainted. Luckily, a lot of the sarcasm is like that. That's just, you know, a small step. It's going to the grand scheme. Yeah. Shrimp's the same thing. Our shrimp industry is tiny here. Everything will import here. So it runs along the same coast.
So they're testing one person out because they're able to get that back and go along the other end.
Yep.
Same way with beef. That's what beef is doing right now. We talk about McDonald's. We can't do our beef here just because it all comes from Africa. There's nothing says they can't ship whatever they want, but there's no FDA approval look at it.
FDA doesn't have enough employees.
Huh?
FDA doesn't have enough employees.
Yeah.
They can't.
I'm just trying to tell you.
Yeah.
This isn't, you know, the beef market's gone down just because of that. Same way with the catfish. They can't compete with what they're shipping over. And you can't. There's not enough overlook it all.
Yeah. I always tell a story. I'll keep the names anonymous. When I worked at OSU main campus, there was a individual postdoc from Poland. Great friend, great guy. I still keep in touch with him. And this was about 15 years ago, and we were going through major headaches on yellow perch and walleye with the Eastern European countries that had just been liberated from the Soviet Union were shipping European perch and pike perch, which is essentially the walleye from Eurasia, and they were mislabeling it and selling it as walleye and yellow perch is what they were doing. They weren't selling it under pike perch or Eurasian perch. And this individual told me we did a little searching. We found we actually found the rivers most of this was coming from. And he told me, he said, "Bill, I've lived there all my life. I would never eat a fish out of those rivers. But yet they were able to ship it all over here." And he said, that river's so polluted with every chemical plant along and everything, he said, "I'd never eat anything out of it. But it gets through our system."
Hey, Bill, we only produce about 1%, right, of the global production?
Yeah, it's very low, 0.46 or something like that. Very low. Very low. And don't get me wrong, I mean, we can increase it, but we're not going to get on the level that China's at right now. Part of it is they value fish as a protein source. We don't value it as much. We like our chicken, our Angus beef. Some of us like Kobe beef, which is really expensive, and other things. So here's a seafood deficit, which means this is the dollar value of what we import versus what we export. We don't export a lot of seafood, but I mean it's actually higher now. That's 2013. I think it's closer to almost $14 billion now. You would think that would be an opportunity for us. If we're importing $14 billion, can't we get a little chunk of that? Seafood consumption has been going down, though. Been going down fairly steadily. In 2004, it was 16 pounds per person in this room. Now, I'm not saying you all ate 16 pounds, but that was the average. And it's gone down to about 14 and a half. It has held steady the last couple of years, finally. But it went down. And a lot of people have been looking as to why that's going on. And when you look at where do most people consume their seafood?
Restaurants.
People are not comfortable with cooking it at home. My wife won't let me because it sinks up the kitchen. But so I have to grill anything outside.
What do you think that the concern about dioxins, toxins, mercury, and radiation?
I think there is a segment of the consumers that are worried about that. I really do. But I think the bulk of them are more worried about price point. Well, there's been a lot of misinformation out on salmon.
Do you have any means by which to assess how that information is impacting this?
There are people researching that on the social science side that show that is important to some, but for most people, it's price point.
You've heard of Safe Catch, mm-hmm. a certification where they're individually testing tuna, or tuna, I guess it is.
Well, tuna is one of those species that can concentrate mercury pretty substantially. Yeah.
Well, I'll say too, Bill, the beef and the pork and the chicken industry have done a lot better job of marketing their product than the seafood sector has.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah.
They've got greater perception.
Well, they're commodities and they have checkoffs and they have the ability to do all that kind of stuff is where the aquaculture doesn't. So U.S. consumer reasons for not eating seafood. And this was in 2008. Taste preference. A lot of people don't like the taste of fish. A lot of people don't. I got two boys. Affordability does tend to be expensive at times compared to other protein sources. Whoops, I must hit the button. And negative messaging from media. Okay, so when you hear things like farm-raised salmon have more PCBs and stuff in it than wild salmon, technically that statement might be true, but if you look at the amounts, it's like, you got to be kidding me. It's essentially the same. It just happens to be one billionth of a thing higher. So, but they get on that. And we are in an era now of the 30-second soundbite. And I would argue we're heading to the 15-second soundbite here before long. So one negative thing, and then people write it off. Mixed messaging is what I was getting out here. I mean, we got a case of where eating fish is heart smart, no doubt about that, omega-3s. But then we have other media that's saying fish to avoid. And the consumer gets confused.
I personally had a case of this. Like, I went out to eat the other night, and they were selling swordfish. And I was like, okay, I thought I wasn't supposed to eat swordfish because I thought there was an overfishing problem. I looked it up online and couldn't get a straight answer. Like, what? And then I wanted to ask the server where they sourced their swordfish, but it seemed like that was an issue. But I didn't want to sound like a jerk and ask her.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, I think the marketing is a huge issue. Like, how do you help people know what to purchase when they go out?
I agree wholeheartedly. But as an aquaculture industry, we're not there.
Yeah.
We are so reactive and trying to react when a negative message comes out instead of being proactive and getting our message out there. That's particularly true of very high-end restaurants in Columbus, because my wife and I, to get seafood, we got to go get it because the two boys won't partake in it. And those high-end restaurants know everything about where their stuff's coming from. I'm not talking Red Lobster here. Okay, you know what I'm talking about. The ones that you can put down a $100 bill and still not cover your dinner. Preferred seafood information source. So where do people go to look? Media? Oh, boy. Internet? Both of those, I would argue, can be misleading. I think there was one more. Health newsletter, physicians? I'm not sure. I know my doctor couldn't tell you. I mean, he says, yeah, I'll eat more seafood, but he's not going to be able to tell me which one is bad for you and good for you. So we need, I would argue, the industry at some point is going to have to get out there and promote ourselves. On a micro scale, you need to go out and educate your purchasers.
Saying, I look at the scientific like papers and stuff just because raising tilapia, I've had quite a few people say, oh, well, I've read this paper. And then if you go and look at the actual paper and see if it was peer-reviewed or if it was even actually about the tilapia, the one I read
farm-raised tilapia in the U.S.
Yeah.
So just fact-checking that to give the people that you're supplying it to, knowing what you have and the research that's out there, what actually applies to your fish.
It's my understanding that tilapia from China are in some very dirty waters.
Could be.
So that could be a selling point also in America. Well, but it's something they hear, you know, tilapia is raised in these conditions.
Well, and
so
I have
think about all tilapia.
Most of my customers are Asian, and like I have one guy that's from China, and he says that he will never buy fish that comes from China.
That tells you something. That's like the Polish guy.
Yeah.
I will never eat from there. When they tell you, listen. But that second bullet there, have you ever heard the thing is, it's on the internet, it must be right. Damn. Jeez. Sustainability. And when Chris talks about sustainability, it's just not environment. Okay, we often hear environmentally sustainable. I mean, true sustainability in the aquaculture setting would be environmentally sustainable, society sustainable, and economically sustainable. And what I mean by that is you have to make money. You have to be sustainable yourself. Regulatory environment challenges, oh boy. Most folks consider permitting to be the major impediment to the growth of aquaculture, U.S. aquaculture. We are regulated far more than other countries growing aquaculture products. There's confusion and complexity. Just talked to somebody here up front about the how ODNR permitting this year and how it changed and added confusion to everything. Aquaculture is often considered a point source as industrial waste. That opens up a whole new headache if you're considered a point source. Costly, difficult, unable to obtain siting permits. Do not touch a wetland. I'll just tell you right now, if you're going to build ponds, do not touch a wetland. I don't care if it's your own wetland, personal property. Do not touch it. We had one bad experience in Ohio recently with that.
What's causing that, though?
What?
We just had I do construction besides that. Like, there's one point disposal or one point excavation for a pond. Like, just build a pond for an owner. He went through an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
He was not allowed to deposit the soil back into a wetland adjacent to it, but he could take the soil out and deposit it elsewhere on his farm, which he did. Soils Conservation Service came in, did a survey of him, and said, you've done everything right, you're okay. So if you do the one-point disposal of the soil, what is the problem with disturbing the wetlands? Because he built it.
Wetlands are federally protected. You can't touch them. You just can't get near them. You just can't touch them.
There's no ceiling on the amount of water.
And those rules can be convoluted in the sense that one U.S. EPA or Army Corps engineer will consider this a wetland and another one won't. That's the problem.
That's kind of what we're seeing.
And I used to teach at OSU the wetland inventory classes and stuff. But anyway, Lacey Act, oh boy, never, ever run afoul of this. Okay, this applies to... it was originally to protect endangered species from being illegally sold and transported across state lines or even in the country. Now it's gotten to the point if, as an example, and Matt, I still call you Jeff, damn. Someday you're just going to kick me in the teeth. You can chime in. But technically, if a neighboring state doesn't allow the sale of tadpoles, and my shipment of perch go across that line into that state, and there's one lousy tadpole in my tank alive, I'm in violation of the Lacey Act. And that wasn't the original tent back when this was created. And those fines are draconian. Draconian. Even if they determine that you had no intention of violating the act, it still can be $100,000 and several years in jail. Now, Rob Portman's trying to correct that. I've been working with his office, Senator, trying to say, okay, let's get back to the original intent of this and not throw farmers or aquaculturists under the bus for an occasional thing. But another example would be guy takes Asian carp on ice from the Mississippi River to Chicago. Okay, they're on ice. And they get there, and an inspector looks at it, and one flops, boom, in the pokey, because one's alive, and you can't have transport live Asian carp. This is some of the stuff we battle. I will say this much, if you stay in Ohio, it's easier. Don't cross state lines if you don't have to. Support and direction. Industry development support structure. Who is really taking the lead in developing aquaculture in Ohio? Okay. Is it the Ohio Aquaculture Association? Yeah, we're vibrant now, but we've had times where we weren't. Government agencies, we're lucky. In Ohio, our agencies are very supportive. We're not like other states that want nothing to do with it. Strategic planning, business planning, these are all challenges, and some of this is all going to be covered as you move through the next 12 months.
No,
that's not the case. What I find is states that have a significant recreational fishing industry, not commercial, but recreational, Michigan, Wisconsin, Minnesota, New York, where they have a big industry devoted to tourism because of recreational fishing. Think muskie, northern pike, walleye up and other things. They are very, very protective of those natural waters. Okay, they have all natural waters. They don't have reservoirs and things like that. They're all natural waters. They're very protective, and they are not pro-aquaculture, in my opinion, that reason. You get into states that don't have natural waters in terms of lakes, like Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, they're far more receptive to aquaculture because they're not trying to protect natural waters and tourism. Success stories, we need success stories. I would argue we got damn far too few of them. And do we really know what our true needs are? There's a lot of difference of opinion as what our needs are. So I'm going to get into some aquaculture, NICRAC stuff, because I'm the Ohio representative on that. And we actually went back in 2014 and sent a survey out to a large number of industry folks, academics, and agency folks. And we asked a number of questions. And we asked them, what are the top three impediments to aquaculture in the north central region? Again, Ohio was part of that. Well, industry regulations came out right now. I mean, that was overwhelmingly number one with industry. We're being overregulated. Feed cost, government support. Then you look at some of the others. There is some commonality there, but there's quite a bit of differences between those three groups. This gets back to leadership. Remember I mentioned who's going to lead the development of the industry? We can't even get an agreement between the three groups. If NICRAC were to focus on three species or groups with the best potential to substantially increase NCR aquaculture in the next 5 years, they would be. And we let those groups, those folks, only check three. Those are the three that popped up. I mean, the list that popped up. Walleye sawguy at the top. This is all groups combined, by the way. I'll pull it apart here in a minute. This is all, whether they're agency or industry, all together. Yellow perch, part of that is because those are two tried and true species of value in the north central region. Trouts and salmonids, largemouth bass. So, you're thinking, from a NICRAC point of view, we're looking at it and we're thinking, oh, okay, we know which ones we should be focusing on. Well, there's not agreement on down the line. Look at industry. Bass was number one for industry. Largemouth bass. Agency folks love yellow perch. The industry's not so hot on it. And then if you look at the in a different way, there is some commonality there in the sense that yellow perch and walleye showed up with all three groups. Again, that's because this is the north central region and these are historical species that everybody likes to eat. How many of you remember growing up with Friday night fish fries back in, I'm not going to try and age everybody, but back in the 70s and 80s? Okay, that was yellow perch dominated at that point. That was yellow perch and walleye to a lesser extent. Now you don't want to know what they're feeding you. Look at the states. This is where it really breaks down. Matt and I, Han Ping, we all sit on NICRAC, and this is the challenge we face. There's no consensus on what. Those are the 12 states in NICRAC. How do we build consensus when every state's got their own priorities? Yes, yellow perch shows up in quite a few of them, but it's down there in the second or third choice. But we're a largemouth bass state. Anybody know why? Why are we a largemouth bass state in terms of aquaculture? Gamefish is one. What's the other? You may not be aware of it. Food fish bass in Ohio has exploded in the last 10 years, heading live haul to the Asian markets on the East Coast. It's gotten quite big. But there's a few, there's some things that don't surprise you. Michigan's trout sell monitor, they got cold water. That's what they want to grow. So again, this is the challenge when we try and build consensus and develop the industry in the North Central region is we have no consensus as to what we should be growing. Systems. We asked in 2014, what are the priorities from a systems standpoint? Well, you folks that are interested, how many of here are really interested in aquaponics? Raise your hand. I do this every time. I don't even want to care. I bet you that's over half of this room. Well, you should be concerned about this. You should be concerned about this because all these folks in the Midwest thought aquaponics was fairly low. But keep in mind, this is relatively new. Aquaponics is relatively new, and most of the respondents were longtime agency folks, not agency, longtime industry folks that, you know, aren't aquaponics people, agency folks, which are not well versed in this stuff in the first place. And then Han Ping, cover your ears, but curmudgeons from universities that really aren't in touch with what's going out. Now I would argue Piketon is in touch with aquaponics, but other universities throughout the Midwest are not. Aquaponics is still a foreign word to them. And then if you look at, this one was great. Remember RES was really high on the previous side? Guess what drove it? Universities. They're fun to, I think it's just because they're fun to play with. No, I shouldn't be that skeptical, but pond culture is with the industry the number one, although RAS is second. Outreach and extension. So if you look out at outreach and extension tools, this is how you educate yourself. That's what extension does. That's what outreach does, to provide you and hopefully science-based information for you to make an informed decision. Okay, that's the whole purpose of what we're doing here. Okay, well, the industry wants to talk to a fellow industry person. Okay, somebody wants to grow yellow perch in ponds, they want to knock my door down. They don't have to knock it down because I'm fairly forthcoming, but there are other people that wouldn't give you the time of day, but you just need to find out who will work with you and who won't. Aquaculture website. But there was some commonality here in the sense that all three groups, industry, academics, and agency folks, thought talking to people that have been there, done that, is very, very valuable. Do not reinvent the wheel is what you're looking at there. That would be a message here. Talk to folks. And, of course, the question Chris had was, is are we being effective at making use of industry expertise? Probably not. Probably not. This is one of the reasons that at an upcoming conference, 8 of those presentations are going to be by producers for you. You're going to get to hear from me, whether you like it or not, and you're going to hear from 7 other producers that have describing their operations and what they've gone through. Reality check. What do we have to show for 20 years of commercial aquaculture in the NCRAC or in the U.S.? Go through this fairly quickly. Here is, there's been three censuses done that we have data for, 98, 2005, 2013. And you can see here with the blue, in 2013, the number of farms went down substantially in the United States. Matt, again, I got it right this time. I had to mentally think that. I'm going to argue that the catfish retrenchment fueled a lot of that. In other words, a lot of those catfish farms down south went out of business because they couldn't compete. The value, though, the farms went up. I mean, that's just basically that we were able to get more for our products. Food fish is by far the biggest, U.S.-wise, total U.S.-wise. Mollusk is a big one, and I would argue it's rapidly expanding. That is a major increase in mariculture and aquaculture on the coast, oysters, other shellfish. Baitfish is the only one that went down. And somebody asked me why that's going down, and that correlates very, very well to the decline in fishing licenses. People don't hunt like they used to, and they aren't fishing like they used to. If you don't have as many fishermen out there, you don't sell as much bait. If you look at the states that changed, the red ones there are the ones that had a decline in aquaculture. Thank God Ohio's not on that list. But nor are we on the bottom one. Those are the states that had an increase in aquaculture. We had an increase, but apparently not enough to be one of those top states. Let's look at the North Central region. We also saw a decline in farms. Well, we're not catfish. Well, we do have some catfish that went down. Missouri, Iowa had a decline in catfish farms. We've lost a lot of perch farms, yellow perch farms. But our value's gone up, too. I know I get quite a bit more for my perch now than I did 10 years ago. In terms of Ohio, here's that we are one of the only two states saw an increase from 2005 to 13. Ohio was one, circled, and Iowa was the other one. All the other ones have been going down or stayed the same. So Ohio's kind of a bright spot in that scenario. And again, that gets back to we are of the 12 states, historically we have the strongest association. We have the most receptive agencies to work with you and try and encourage aquaculture. So it's right now a fairly good scenario. And in terms of value, we also are one of the few states that showed any increase in value in the last 8 years. Ohio aquaculture. Hey, we're going to get done on time here, I think. So we've actually seen an increase in the number of farms. By the way, this doesn't have aquaponics in it yet. Can you imagine what? I can't wait till they do 2021. They do this about every 8 years. Okay, 2021, but it'll be quite a jump. And our value has gone up a fair amount. Keep in mind, when you look at that, it's pretty well accepted by the USDA who does this, that only about 25% of the farms report. Most folks just, it's from the government, ain't. So a little bit about our production at a glance. Food fish, almost all largemouth bass. We're growing some others here, but I should have highlighted largemouth bass in some other color. That is our major food fish in the state. Just off the top of my head, I would guess 90% of our food fish is largemouth bass. Live haul to eastern markets. Some rainbow trout up along Lake Erie. Tilapia used to be bigger. I only know of one guy left in Ohio that's really, although there are a few now. Just today I heard of a few others that are growing it. But Jerry Wendell over near Fort Recovery is a big tilapia producer. Live hauls into the Columbus market, or used to. Sport fish. These are fish that we grow and sell for pond and lake stocking, okay? Largemouth bass is still the biggest. Bluegill, sunfish, rainbow trout. Black rainbow trout's an enigma. We sell a lot of rainbow trout for stocking Ohio ponds and lakes for the winter fishing. Okay, a lot of rod and gun clubs, fishing game clubs want something that their members can catch during the winter for fishing or for children's hooked on fish, not on drugs programs, whole things. And trout fits the bill because they eat all winter. I always tell folks, though, you had better caught everyone by about May 1, or you'll know how many you didn't catch during the winter, because they will die. They can't take the temperatures. Yellow perch. It's what I do. I am a wholesaler of yellow perch to pond and lake management companies. I don't do any food fish right now. It's all companies coming in, and I don't have to deliver them. They come and get them. Yellow perch. Koi and goldfish, that's a big industry. We don't take advantage of, folks. If I was putting in an aquaponics system right now and wanted something I could move in a heartbeat, it'd be koi and goldfish. So what will it take to be successful in Ohio? Okay, we need to gain social acceptance. This gets back to that sustainability stool you saw. Environmental consciousness, we cannot have a message where we are environmentally trashing the environment. We cannot do that. Do not even consider it. It's one of our selling points is that we will be environmentally conscious. We need to engage stakeholders, gain government support, engage state leaders. We want to operate there in the middle. We want to be socially conscious, environmentally sustainable, economically viability, same time. Okay, short term. This is a big thing with NCRAC. We're going through this in terms of short term, how can we grow this industry? Most of us believe short term we need to expand and establish aquaculture enterprises along proven species, technologies, and markets. So these are the four species that we do quite well with biologically. Bass, yellow perch, tilapia, rainbow trout. Doesn't mean you can't do something else. I mentioned the koi and goldfish would be interesting, but these are the four that work well. The culture system that is proven biologically and profitable are pond culture systems. They're forgiving. What I mean by that is, in a intensive indoor system, if a pump goes down, you are down to minutes. You are down to minutes. A pond, you know, in terms of oxygen depletion, in a pond, especially after you've done it for a few years, you will know several days in advance that something's not kosher, and you can take remedial actions. My wife says I can read a pond, and she's probably right. I can just detect a color change and know, uh-oh. Make sure the paddle wheels are ready to go. Algae crash is coming, even by a slight, subtle color change. And our proven markets right now are live fish, live haul, bass particularly, but you could do tilapia if you had to. That's been proven. That's going on big time in Ohio now. And most of everybody else is selling their species, like I do, to pond and lake management companies. That includes Jenny Blackburn at Fresh Harvest Aquaponics. She's selling her yellow perch. I broker them for it into the pond and lake stocking, not food fish. Those are the two proven markets right now. However, in the future, we're going to have to look at some other things. Bluegill, maybe sawguy. Anybody know what this species is right here? Barramundi? Who did that? Who said that? Yeah, well, I would expect you. You see? That's barramundi. That's all the rage in Iowa right now.
You find that we're allowed to have barramundi
here? I'd have to check. I think it's on the list.
I'm sure it's class B.
Yes. And we can get it. Class A's are species on your aquaculture permit. You can grow that anywhere in Ohio with no restrictions other than you've got a thing. Class B's are you can grow them, but they have to come and inspect your facility and make sure there's two levels of containment. to keep them from getting loose. Okay, and I would argue at some point we're going to, this is an RAS system. I like to play with them. I have real reservations as to whether they're going to be economically feasible for Ohio aquaculture. There's the whole Midwest is littered with failed RAS systems. However, aquaponics, I think, has great, great potential. Okay, it is an indoor system, but it's far less complex. You have another revenue stream beside your fish. I think there's real potential there. And then I would argue we got to get, well, I mean, the live haul and pond lake stocking will probably continue, but at some point to grow Ohio aquaculture, we've got to get into these high-end niche markets. We've got to. Not Red Lobster, Bob Evans. We've got to get in. Okay. Into those high. I get calls all the time. Chef Layla in Columbus is driving me nuts, asking where she can get Ohio-grown perch and whatever. I said, well, we can get it to you if you can clean it. We'll talk about that, but we don't have HACCP processing plants in Ohio that were willing to work with us. But they will pay a premium. Those high-end restaurants will pay a premium for locally grown, locally sourced stuff. And that's not only fish. That includes aquaponics, too. We need to invest in research, education, and outreach. You know, as the OAA, we can do a lot of that, working with Piketon and others. You know, we're going to have at least three more workshops this year, the OAA will, that if you come to the conference, you'll actually see what they'll be. One's aquaponics. I'll just give it away real quick, but there'll be actually three all-day workshops that we'll have. We got to reduce production cost in all our systems. Even ponds, we got to reduce it. Okay, feed cost. Okay, you got to do it. I told you one way we did it: 27% decline. You got to do it. Tag on to somebody. Be honest with you. If you are anywhere in Central Ohio and you don't come see me at some point about feed costs, because we'll get it to you at the same cost we get. Fingerling cost, capital cost. Energy usage, electricity is a big deal, especially if you're an indoor intensive. But even in ponds, those paddle wheels are high amp draws. They pull a lot of electricity when you have to have them. Okay. Insurance as in liability?
Yeah, anything to do with the
house. I have liability insurance, meaning I have insurance that covers, well, if a tornado destroys my building and stuff, it covers that too. But I have liability. So if you come and visit, for example, let's say we do a bus tour and you guys come and visit my farm, I have liability insurance, not for the bus. If the bus driver messes up, that's their problem. But if for some reason you're walking around a pond and something happens, I have liability insurance to cover you. It's relatively cheap. But there is no insurance that I know of, and Matt, you can chime in, that replaces fish loss. That I have been told there is some insurance coming up shortly for indoor systems where they can count the fish, where you can say, document, I've got 8,000 fish in here, and this is what happened. Now, you know, power went off, I lost all 8,000, blah, blah. Ponds are a whole different story because you can't see them. You can't see them.
Did you form an LLC?
Yes. Oh, God, please do that. Who's covering that later? Okay, Chris. Please do that. And Chris will talk at some point about the advantages of an LLC. I don't know if you share that, Chris, or not, but I would have an LLC. Yeah. Limited liability corporation. I've got folks that formed it, and it's just them. That's all it is. Cooperatives, I really think cooperatives are going to be the way to go. I really do. For some people, that is a four-letter word, but I think cooperatives are going to be what we need. We're going to have to. And I'll talk a little bit about that here in a minute. Oh, here I go. Okay, here's an example. This is not the way it is really, although I would argue the Blue Stars, which are the high-end restaurants in Columbus, that's a way under an estimation of what's there. Okay, but what we need are cooperatives that have growers outside. We don't have that many growers out there. This is kind of a wish, the red boxes. that have all these growers growing fish, aquaponics, greens, whatever, for this market right here. Okay, population 1 million. This is the Ace of Spades in Ohio. I'm not demeaning Columbus and Cincinnati and Dayton, but this is the Ace of Spades because Columbus is a young city. It's a vibrant, well-off city. I don't know how to say that politically correct, but our average capita per person is way over the national average. We have very affluent suburbs, lots of high-end restaurants. I swear to God, nobody cooks in Columbus anymore. You go on a Monday or Tuesday night to a restaurant, and we're still waiting in line. Okay, this is the Ace of Spades. I'm not demeaning the other cities, but this is the Ace of Spades. This city will suck up everything we can grow for a while. I get calls anywhere from 25 to 30 a year from restaurants looking for locally grown stuff. On aquaponic stuff, I've been able to get that stuff and help people move into these restaurants because there's very little processing involved with that. There are some strange rules, but we don't have to gut the fish, clean them. And so we've been able to tap into that. On the fish side, we haven't been able to tap into that. The reason is, what do you have to process fish? Anybody know?
HACCP plan.
HACCP plan, right. That's a federal regulation. The minute you touch, cut open that fish, fillet it, you've got to have a HACCP-approved plan. And people, small operations like ourselves, can't afford it because it's not, I've been through the course just for shits and giggles, pardon my language. But your facility, it's all stainless steel equipment. All the walls and floors and ceilings got to be a certain material so they're washable. Got to have freezer, the whole nine yards. And little farms like us can't pull the plug on that. It's hard to do. So what we need, I don't know if it'll reach this far, what we need is a cooperative that owns its own processing facility right next to Columbus. Picture this. Matt over there is in charge of the cooperative processing facility for our cooperative. We're all in this cooperative. And we all funnel our stuff in. I don't care if it's fish or aquaponics. You all funnel it in, and it gets taken care of, packaged, and goes into these high-end restaurants. What kind of price do you think you're going to get if you can do that? You're going to get a premium price for that stuff. Because yellow perch, for example, coming from Lake Erie, capture fisheries, going to Columbus, if you can find it, changes hands. Laura told me 5 times. Everybody's got their hand. The middle three got their hand in that profit. So if you can get cooperatives that all we want the cooperative to do is break even. There is a cost associated with the processing facility and the cooperative, but break even. Make sure Matt can get paid. I've got your name right now 4 times in a row. Okay, just make sure it breaks even. No profit. We don't have to worry about profit with the processing facility and the cooperative. So we can charge this premium price for what's going into Columbus. That should allow those fish growers to get double what they'll get from the Lake Erie processors if you sold them up there. We've run the numbers. We just need a green dot next to Columbus. And it don't have to be up there. It could be somewhere else.
What does this facility cost?
A cooperative?
The cooperative-owned processing facility.
We price, if you use machines, scaling and filleting machines, we rented the space. About $110,000, $115,000. Machines are expensive. Now, if you want to use hand cutters, it's a lot cheaper. Okay, it's a lot cheaper. You don't want me cleaning your fish.
Yeah.
You don't want me. That yield will be terrible.
This is an aquaculture, but Michigan has a lot of small-time hops growers, and they put together the Michigan Hops Alliance because a wolf hops processing machine is $250,000. They've got the machine. They're doing it. Seems very, very reasonable.
Yep, and the filleting machine and a scaling machine, a good used one will run you $25,000 to $30,000 a pop for both of them. So $60,000 to $65,000. You don't even want to look at them new. There's enough on the market you can find. In fact, I could tell you where there's two right now. That's what's good.
Is that what Kentucky does with that?
They have a mobile. Yeah. Matt and I can talk about that in Ohio. But anyway, not to hold up lunch too long here, but folks, I know you live around the state, but this is the ace of spades. This Columbus.
But let me just make sure I have that right. You're saying it's more affordable to pay an actual person to process rather than a machine to purchase?
It's up front, it's less because you're not buying the machines. Front, at some point, you'd like to go to the machines.
Because you're going to get more.
Okay, I'm just thinking job-wise. Like, my goal in Putnam is to produce jobs for local people.
Mm-hmm. You can do that. I mean, the Lake Erie processors up there don't use, they use a scaling machine.
Okay.
That's boring.
Sure.
They use a scaling machine, but they have hand cutters. And the reason up there is the perch have to be butterflied.
Yeah.
No machine will do that. Down here, when I talk to these restaurants, they say, I don't care if that yellow perch is butterflied or not.
Okay.
So you could use machines on yellow perch down here because they don't care.
Okay.
Now, up there, what they do is those aren't full-time employees. Okay, these, most of the two facilities I've worked with when I used to do food fish, those are grandmothers and at home, stay-at-home moms that just want to work part-time.
But we have people like that in Putnam.
So that's what they're doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I always used to tease the wives because I said, man, God, you're so good with a knife. I wouldn't want to be married with you. I run afoul of you, and I'm in real trouble. But they are incredibly good. I'm not it. I have seen people flaying fish that it's unbelievable what they do. It's unbelievable what they do. But they got to be HACCP. You still have to be HACCP, even if you use hand cutters or machines. But that's what we're going to need here.
I know you're trying to get co-ops together for so many different reasons, but why haven't all these people gotten together and done one of these like you're talking? If it's only
trust.
Is that what it's all about?
That's all that's about. It's trust. We've had meetings. Laura, too, and I used to have meetings. It's all about trust. If you form a, and we're going to go over into lunch a little bit, but when you all get your lunch, I'll talk about the OAA while you're eating. But I didn't expect this many questions. If you're forming a purchasing cooperative, okay,
I mean, we do
which is,
with electrical and plumbing,
yeah, so. With feed and plumbing, that's easy. Nobody gets their feelings hurt because everybody's getting 27% off our feed. When you form a cooperative that is marketing, purchasing fish from everybody in this room, so Matt's going to be doing this, and we're all going to be part of this, and we're going to send our fish in, okay, to him, to the processing facility, he's got to be fair. He doesn't want to show you favoritism. If that gets out, you're in trouble. The cooperative will start to fall apart. It has to be fair. It has to have a well-defined set of rules. Officers that are trustable, and you cannot, you've got to be cognizant of being purchasing from everybody. You have to be upfront, and that's where cooperatives get in trouble, but that's a marketing cooperative, and that's where those get in trouble. That doesn't mean you can't have a cooperative that does everything, but the marketing portion is the minefield. It's all about trust. Yeah, that's the other aspect. People don't want to be a part because I might get 10 cents. You can't think that way because if the co-op can't get the product in to move, then they're going to alienate the Blue Stars and you're in trouble. You've got to have total buy-in. Unless the board gives you permission to go ahead and do it. That can happen. That does happen on occasion. We're near the end, I promise here. But anyway... By the way, the special workshop before the conference on the 27th of January is dealing with cooperative formation. So you might want to be there. Okay, we're getting to the end. Permitting and regulation, and this is where the OAA can help, and we lead, and we work on this. And I didn't used to be this bold until I started working with agencies. But we need to... simplify the permitting, and luckily we're in a state that's willing to work with us on this. We've had some hiccups, but they're willing to work. Some of these federal agencies, oh boy. We're from the government, and we're here to help you. This is a problem we have in Ohio, and we're getting near, I swear to God, we're getting near the end. We'll make a beeline for the food, but we don't have any animal health people in Ohio. You get into trouble, and there's not the expertise. There's not the expertise. I went through a long process here trying to convince OSU Veterinary College to create a position here in the last 6-7 months. And they were very receptive, but basically the message was we want an endowment, which means they want an outside funding source to fund the entire position, and that we're not an industry that has those kinds of sugar daddies associated with it, so we couldn't get it.
Maybe you shouldn't go out to eat so often.
Yeah. So we have a problem with health here. We have, if you have to have your fish health tested for federal regulations, crossing state lines type of thing, we have, I only know of two vets that are capable of, one vet that can take the necropsy samples to send, meaning you have to get a kidneys and livers or whatever out. There's another vet that if you're willing to send the whole fish to the lab, he can, he'll do the chain of custody. You might find vets willing to do that for you. Again, if you go to your local vet, say, can you take out the kidney and whatever, and it's not going to happen. We need to rectify that. We have got to get that changed. We got to strengthen water quality monitoring. That is the number one thing that will get you in trouble with your fish. This is a pet peeve of mine. I know Matt talks about this a lot in his stuff, too. You've got to maintain good water quality for the species you're growing. And use BMPs. These are best management practices. There are books out there. I give a lot of talks on this kind of stuff. Water quality BMPs, feeding BMPs, those kinds of things. Finally, leadership. We've got an effective state association right now. Hopefully it stays that way. Strengthen trade associations. The NAA, I would argue, National Aquaculture Association, has done a complete 360 and is now much more effective than they were 10 years ago. And Ohio State is a big player in this, both at main campus and here. And so the last thing is if we do all this, where are we going to be when the next thing comes out? And hopefully we're growing. I would prefer we're out here and not back here. But that's our goal, both as an industry, as growers, that's where we need to be.
Okay, y'all, I sure do appreciate everybody coming today. I already did introductions, but I'll do it real quick anyways, just to make sure. My name is Matt Smith. Going to talk about planning out your aqua venture. Basically, a lot of questions that you need to consider before you really get going, which is a big trouble for all of us because we like to jump in, head first into the water rather than just getting our toes wet a little bit. So we'll kind of run through this. This is, I think, a 40-minute talk or so, but if y'all have questions, you can ask me during. It's not a big deal. There's a lot to cover, but in case they didn't already kind of let you know, you kind of already figured it out. All of these are recorded, so don't feel you got to memorize everything because it'll be up on the ABC website very soon for y'all to go back to anyways. There's a lot of hyperlinks and things like that within my PowerPoint presentation, so you can go back through and hopefully those will all be clickable for you so you can click on the links and go there and kind of get lost in the world of resources for you. So kind of start off, this little piece of paper kind of on the left side is, if I'm going to start a bait fish farm from the very beginning, what are some of the questions that I kind of need to ask before I, dive right in? And these are going to kind of keep coming up throughout the presentation. But basically, it'll start in a second. So there's plenty of questions to ask when you first get going. A lot of overwhelming. A lot of you already have your businesses, so it's a lot less overwhelming. But for those of you who don't, it gets a little hairy because each question you have within that question, there's another dozen questions that you have to be able to answer. And each one's just kind of a stepping stone. It's a tree. So it takes a little while for you to figure out exactly what types of questions you need to ask. And then within each of those questions, how are you going to go about answering those? But of course, it's necessary to improve your chances of success. That's the reason you're here as part of ABC, we're here to help you be successful. We're here to help you shorten your learning curve. A lot of y'all could figure this out. You spend hours and hours and hours and days on the internet doing all your proper research. You can figure it out yourselves. But that's part of the reason why you're here is to help shorten that learning curve so that we can help you improve your chance of success. It's also why we partner with OAA along with others as well. Answering the questions roughly the correct order is often by far the best way to go about it. What I hear a lot of, like I said, I've only been here 10 months, but I did extension work a little bit down south too, and you hear a lot of the same stuff. A lot of people will start out with, they might not know anything else, but they've heard or they try to fish or they've done something and they decided, this is what I'm going to grow. That's just it. No, nothing else matters. This is the species I'm going to grow. Tilapia, goldfish, bass, whatever, doesn't matter. A lot of people just hit on that and they get stuck on it. And that's not really the best way to go about it. Then they'll try to figure out how am I going to pay for it, which of course is one of the first steps to think about. But if you notice, they're quite a bit out of order. And then they'll figure out where my farm's going to be located. If I figure out how I'm going to pay for it, but then you got to figure, do I already have the farm or do I already have a garage that I've kicked the wife's car out of? Can I put it in there to start with? If not, are you going to have to purchase your land? Where is it going to be? All that type of stuff gets into considerations. Once you figure out, I'm going to fund this, now where am I going to put my property at? Then when they start figuring out whether or not they're going to have to purchase other land, then oftentimes you'll figure out, well, what's my goals? Am I really going to spend all this money on it? Or is this really just kind of an extreme hobby of mine, which I'm not really, I'm hoping to make money at, I'm hoping to retire with, all these types of things. But once again, it's another question asked out of order. And then eventually you often hear where your market's at, where you're going to actually grow your species. And that's not really the way you want to look at things. And then a lot of times money is often spent on physical items before answering your questions. A lot of people like to buy warehouses or buy their land and all these types of things before they've gone through and actually figured out exactly how they should be doing things. Starting at the top, I've got posters out there and I've got given other presentations. That's kind of your first goal is, what are my goals? What am I looking to do? Am I looking to just feed the family? Is this just a hobby type thing of my own? Am I looking for retirement money? I'm going to make money the next 5-10 years, retire, and then I'll be set for it. Part-time, full-time, am I just wanting to be an investor? I want to learn a little bit more about this and invest in another company that's came to me, or I have a friend that's interested in doing it, and I want to learn about it before I go invest it into their company. Or a combination, or a bunch of I don't really know. This is a little tough to see. I apologize. I was hoping it looked a little prettier. But everyone is at a good start, of course, being a part of ABC2. How much you really know about aquaculture, it's quite difficult. One of the most difficult things is that every species is highly different. The DOs need to be different, the ammonia, the temperature, how they breed is completely different, where you're going to sell your products completely different. It doesn't matter, even if it's both a food fish, things can be going about very differently. Whether it's a largemouth bass or a yellow perch, they're going to spawn very differently. So it takes a lot of expertise to really go about it in the right way. Your opportunity costs, as you're thinking about starting this business, a lot of people said they haven't really started. They just want to take this to figure out whether or not they should actually get into this. And I think that's a good way to look about it. You want to figure out my opportunity cost, whether it's my natural resources, all my wells that I have on the farm, or whether I have an abandoned building or whatever it might be. What could I put that to better use at? And it is a kind of a compare and contrast. If I don't do this aquaponics thing, can I do X, Y, or Z over here with it instead and be a lot more profitable at it? Those are just other considerations to think about. And a lot of people are already involved in agriculture, but it is quite difficult. A lot of people have very few vacations, long hours, and failures kind of, especially we've already mentioned dead fish quite a bit here. It just happens. There's no way around it. And then a thing to consider is your marketing and your sales ability. A lot of people who have a marketing and sales background is a lot easier for you, but maybe the farming aspect's not. That's just the other way around. If you've been on a farm your entire life and have always just sold to someone who brokers your product, and you've never once had to go directly to a restaurant and say, this is my product, this is why it's the best, all these types of things. It can be a very big headache, and it's quite intimidating because you want to stay on the farm. You want to get up early in the morning, and you want to watch your crops grow, and you want to sell it off to somebody and not worry about it. It's quite a different than walking into a hipster brewery that's going to buy your freshwater shrimp because it's locally grown. Big difference there between the type of interactions that you might have to deal with. Got to realize your limitations. A lot of this stuff's already been mentioned by Bill, but attending your classes and your workshops, all those types of things. Visit your farms and take care of take advantage of any internships that come along your way, especially if they're local to you and you don't have to go very far. If you're looking at large-scale operations, you know, most of us here, we are very beginners. We're going to start small, which is kind of the proper way to go about it. But if you are looking at going ahead and spending a lot of money at this, there are aquaculture engineers out there. That's all they do. There are aquaculture economists out there. That's all they do. If you come to them with a very well put together business plan, they are consultants. They're not going to be free, and we don't, you know, advocate for one over the other. But there are, if you do your homework, there are very well respected folks out there that'll be gladly to take a little bit of your money, but also offer you some very good feedback. And then also, just because you hire one engineer, you know, like I said, there's very few of us, but you hire one person to help design your system. There's nothing wrong with having another on retainer that just reviews another person's plan. That cost is going to be a lot cheaper just going through and reviewing a plan rather than actually developing one yourself. But, you know, these are very large-scale stuff that most of us won't have to worry about, at least not yet. You start small and scale up from there, then you can worry about it. Learn from your .edu resources, osu.edu, along with numerous others out there. But all of this stuff, you know, we're land-grant universities. We're just here to look at the science, look at the data, and to just kind of put it out there for you in extension fact sheets and things of that nature. But I'm not trying to sell you on anything. I'm not trying to sell you on our particular aquaponic systems back there or our RAS system or whatever it may be. You go to somebody else at the .com, whatever, you know, there's often a lot of good information there, and a lot of their information links to .edu resources. But go ahead and go straight to the source, because these people are trying to sell you on stuff. And a lot of times their products are good. They might be just hunky-dory. But it's kind of one of the best things to do is to start at the source and then kind of use your judgment to figure out where you're going to go from there along the ways. And, of course, network from other farmers. Learn from Bill Lynch. Every mistake he's made, ask him about it, and don't do the same thing. It's a lot cheaper on your part. A lot of resources, all of these that are red underlined are hyperlinks. Will they be able to click on it? Well, we'll send them to you. But all of these go to different places. So starting out at southcenters.osu.edu, starting out at our Buckeye Aquafarming stuff, our Ohio Aquaculture Association stuff, Texas A&M University Fisheries has a kind of a newer website that they've really thrown some money towards. They're wanting it to be kind of a one-stop shop for a lot of aquaculture information. So it'll be anything from vendors and suppliers to water quality to fish disease, and it's kind of elaboration of SHRAC extension publications, Southern Regional Aquaculture Center, kind of that just expanded a little bit. And then UW Stevens Point is a partner on OAA or on this ABC grant, and they have a lot of public education, have a lot of good stuff on their website as well. As Bill mentioned, a lot of us are involved with NICRAC, and you can see our 12 states there. SHRAC or SRAC, Southern Regional Aquaculture Center, that's where the majority of your good publications and videos are going to be located on this. If you want to learn anything about how pH, alkalinity, and carbon dioxide are related in fish ponds or whatever, you can go there and they'll tell you with scientific data to back it up in layman's terms what it all means and why it can be a consideration for you and your ponds and things like that. So it's science-based stuff, but adds it in a good way. The ADDL, that's the Disease Diagnostics Lab that Bill mentioned earlier, that is part of the Ohio Department of Agriculture. So when you do have sick fish, we always hope you never do, but when you do, you can go on and visit their website and see about some of the stuff they have. There are other associations, you know, aquaculture associations in the region. Our neighboring state is Indiana, so they do have an Indiana Aquaculture Association as well. Some of y'all have signed up probably for our listservs. Might have seen they recently had an aquaponics conference come up as well. Of course, Kentucky State does their own extension research. Hocking College here, not too far. They've got education and resources on their website as well. BCC is a little bit farther away over in Wilmington, North Carolina, but they've got a lot of good stuff on there. Good friends with the director there, but it's Brunswick Community College. But just other places that you can get .edu resources from. Not everything has to come from the .coms. Conservation Fund, if you're really interested in like your larger scale RAS stuff, they do a lot of commercial scale RAS work. They look at a lot of salmon research there. That's another nonprofit organization as well. The Food Safety Modernization Act pertains to our aquaponics folks. We'll hear about it 1,000 times over. Then you have FAO, USDA, APHIS, which stands for Animal Plant Health Inspection Service. They're looking at trying to come up with a better way to regulate aquaculture products. Aquaculturists are not anti-regulations. We are anti-over-regulations. There's a point where you can be regulated out of the industry, just like in every other part of agriculture. We want to be sustainable and protect the environment. We want to provide good protein at a reasonable price, but we also don't want to be regulated out of business either. It's just a way to protect house and home. And then, of course, NIFA is the funding agency on there. So they fund a lot of good they fund some good aquaculture research projects as well. On the FAO, you can see on the right, they do have a, some of y'all I'm sure have seen it already, a very extensive small-scale aquaponic production manual. It's, I don't know, 400 or 500 pages long, very long, but they talk about a lot of good stuff in there. So once again, just another thing to consider for you as well. Like I said, you don't have to memorize all that because we'll talk about it over the next 12 months, but just to give you an idea of some of those .edu resources to tap into. What's your source? I'm not a business person, so I'm not going to tell you about your source of funding. That'll be left over to, of course, our small business development team. But you got to be realistic in your considerations. The G word isn't a guarantee and is often elusive, your grant funding. A lot of those times it's just for the only people that can really apply are those who are already in the business. Well, if you're just starting out, that already shuts you out of a lot of those. There are people that get them, but it's stuff you can talk about later. But I wouldn't base everything solely on the desire for any types of grants. Of course, start small and work your way up. You got to have a small system, especially if you've never grown aquaculture. You don't have a business partner that's part of aquaculture for 10, 20 years, whatever. It is a lot of hard work to grow fish. Tilapia is kind of the exception because they grow in just about anything. But if you're going to do other species, some things are very, very difficult to grow. You'd rather spend very little money on a small system, kind of work out some of your kinks, and work on scaling up from there. You don't want to spend all these hundreds of thousands of dollars, even tens of thousands of dollars, if you're going to learn down with a couple $1,000 system that I have no idea what I'm doing and I really don't want to spend the time to learn about it. I'd rather do something else with my time. What species are you interested in growing? I keep throwing interested in there, and I blacked it out earlier because that's what I hear a lot. This is a species I'm going to grow. That's fine and dandy to have a species you're interested in growing. I'm interested in growing fancy goldfish, and I think they would be cool. But you need to be flexible. If your market says, yeah, sure, we'll buy your shabumpkins or your fancy goldfish, but we're only going to pay you X number of dollars, well, if you need to have, instead of two, you need to have three just to cover costs, it doesn't make a lot of sense to force that on you. You know, yeah, it's great. You can have your own little hobby scale, a small little system because you think they look very pretty. But if you can't sell it, then there's no really point in growing them. Of course, unless you're just trying to sustain your own family and you're not looking for profits, then you can kind of do what makes you happy or what the local folks want. But if you're trying to make money, listen to the market and what they have to say. Or they might say, I want your tilapia, and then when they come to pick them up, they're willing to pay you $2 a pound for them, and you're going to need at least $3.25 to cover cost. Yeah, you hit the right species, but if you're not able to grow them for the correct price, what's the point in going through all of it in the first place? You know, you'd rather be smart about it and invest your money correctly in the right way. And then the market research just take a lot of time to deal with, as I mentioned, especially with agriculture. A lot of people aren't necessarily good sales folks, or they might be good sales folks to brokers. You know, I can convince you because I kind of know what your end game is, but I might not be able to go to the brewery down the street and sell my freshwater shrimp. It might be a little bit more difficult there. The only reason I say shrimp is because there is a big local food movement, and someone mentioned not wanting to be to seem kind of weird by asking where their seafood comes from. I was there 2 weeks ago, I'm not naming names, but I went to the brewery, hipster place. I mean, just there are people everywhere, just slam full, 40-minute wait. Jumbo shrimps on the menu sounded really good. I think it was shrimp and grits. That sounds fantastic. Ask the lady where the shrimp's coming from. It's coming from Vietnam. No, thank you. I'll just have a burger or something else that I know from here in the United States. So I wouldn't fret too much about it. But being able to get, these are untapped markets. They might just not even know that they need to be asking the questions to get them from here rather than Vietnam. And that's fresh, local. You know, a lot of those brew type places are all about the local, and maybe a lot of the products are. Maybe all the greens are for the salad and everything else, but that's where seafood falls short. Oftentimes, you got to take the time to go out and market to folks like that, and maybe you can come up with a better tasted product for just a little bit more. They can still take money on it, and they're going to be able to command a higher price because they do hit better on the fresh and the local, rather than someone asking and saying it comes from China. Where's your market? All this stuff will be hit 1,000 times over, but you know, hobbies, you pour money into hobbies, you get enjoyment out, but that's really about it most of the time. Wholesale, retail, Bill already discussed live, on ice, all those types of things, so I really won't hit on them too much there. Of course, we are one of the best. You look at shrimp and bass, perch, bluegill, all these types of species that were already mentioned, and the potential for them. That Bill was discussing. Where is your farm going to be located? As I mentioned, you have the land available there to you, or do you need to purchase it? How this land is zoned plays a big part, and it'll be hit on here in just a few minutes a little bit better. You know, depending on where you're located, really, really matters. Bill talked about surrounding Columbus, how the great potential is there. The closer you are to your market, definitely going to cut your costs down a lot. Bill mentioned largemouth bass kind of being the number one food fish. Well, where do you think all of our fingerlings, when we start out, all of our farmers here, where are all the fingerlings coming from of the largemouth bass? Anybody know where our largemouth bass fingerlings come from? It's not Ohio. It's coming from Arkansas. That's 11 and a half hours in a truck that they got to be shipped up here. That's a lot of money for gas. That's a lot of money to pay a skilled person that knows what they're doing to be able to haul those fish, keep them alive and healthy at a very small age. But it's not just your bass, it's a lot of your bluegills and stuff like that. That's very expensive to ship stuff that far. So it might not be a terrible cost on their end, on Arkansas's end, to produce them to that size. Feed is going through the roof for all of us. But especially for those guys, they've got to get them up to a couple inches depending on how big you want them. But then they're going to charge us an outrageous amount to be able to buy from them. Because shipping is very, very expensive. So the closer you are to your market, on our side, we think about, we don't want to ship, as Bill mentioned, you know, we don't necessarily want to hit the Chicago market because it takes a lot of gas to get there and a lot of time and effort when you could tackle Columbus as well. So thinking about where your farm's located, how close you are to the market, plays a huge consideration for you. On the land and water suitable for production, one of the things you hear, at least a pretty good bit in some of your extension publications, is that most waters fish can live in. Fish are pretty hardy animals. They can live in a lot of situations. But here in aquaculture, and we're trying on the farming sides of things, we don't just want them to live, we want them to thrive. We want them to grow as fast as possible up to market without compromising their health. And a lot of times the health is compromised due to poor water quality. That's what a lot of it stems from. If you have stressors because of poor water quality, that allows them to be vectors for other diseases or parasites or whatever else might be in the environment. Anybody who's ever held a fish, they're very, very slimy. That slime coat, well, some species, that slime coat really protects their bodies and helps keep diseases out. If they get stressed, a lot of that slime coat kind of sloughs off. Anything that might have been in that water that wouldn't have harmed them before, because of a protecting coat, can then make your fish sick. So even though you might have decent water available, always keeping the water at optimal levels is definitely going to give you the best kind of return on your investment. It's a lot of work, and there are some chemistry involved with figuring out what all this water quality stuff means, but it definitely pays for itself in the long run. Is it reliable power? Being a part of Extension, we're on these big Ohio State Extension listservs that every time an Extension office, all 88 of them throughout the county, or throughout the Ohio, because there's 88 counties here, at least once a week, power's out for the week, or at least for the time being in so-and-so county. We'll let you know when power's back on. Well, if you're trying to run a business, especially as Bill said, you got moments to react to like an RAS system where it's highly intensive. You lose power and your pump cuts off. You only have a few minutes. You know, figuring out having backup sources is very expensive. But if you're trying to make money at this more than just a hobby scale, a lot of times it's a necessity. You know, you might say that you've got a couple thousand dollars worth of product in your tanks. I'm not going to make that much money on them. I might even lose a little bit of money because I'm still figuring out what I'm doing. I'm not going to spend the money on some type of pump to save them. Well, the moment you say that, pump's going to go out. You're going to end up losing your fish and saying, man, or say it wasn't even a pump. You know, water quality got bad, the oxygen dropped down. If I'd have spent $300, $1,500, whatever it might be, on a great water quality meter, I might could have saved my fish, and that meter would have paid for itself immediately just by me going out and checking it. I mean, like Bill said, he can kind of tell when his ponds are starting to get in trouble before it even happens, especially looking at the data he collects. But that's something you can do yourself, too, to help protect you. Yes, it is an investment, but businesses are an investment. And don't skimp when you don't really need to in situations like protecting your farm. And then how far are your suppliers, your markets, as I already touched on? Do you need permits to grow your species? Bill gave kind of a little overview about a few of the Lacey Act and things like that he mentioned, but a lot of y'all's faces are familiar because either I saw you at Farm Science Review or I saw you at the OAA ABC Beginner Workshop right here next door. He gave a very good talk on all things regulations. I think he called it Regulations You Need to Know. It's on the OAA's website, ohioaquaculture.org, but it's like 50 minutes and it talks all about regulations, so I'll kind of hit over briefly on these, but there's no point in reinventing the wheel and spending 40 minutes to sit here and talk about all of them again. But chances are you probably do need at least one permit, and that is, as Bill mentioned, Class A or Class B species. That'll determine both your price, and then also there's a free fish transportation and bait dealer permits, and then if you're going to sell wholesale, now it's, I think, $65 to sell wholesale, which is new. And then there's just kind of a screen capture of what's on their website, and you can not clearly because it's a little small, I guess, but you can see there's two sections, Class A and then Class B, and you can go through and list the species. If they're not listed there, you can list them as B species, and then ODNR will contact you and see about sending out a local representative and make sure you don't have a couple areas of escape and all that type of stuff, because it is about ODNR being very welcoming to aquaculture, but also a desire to protect our natural resources, which we have no problem doing. We just want to make sure it's done the right way. There are EPA permits. Wetland protection's already been touched on, but that is all involved with the Clean Water Act. To be concerned about whether you need a NPDES permit, lots of acronyms, of course, National Pollutant Discharge Elimination Service permit. A lot of that depends on what species you're growing. You know, are these warm or cool water species? How many pounds of feed you're feeding to your system? How many pounds of fish you have in there? It really is based on mostly upon the amount of feed you're going to be adding to this system. Because if you're just dumping gobs of feed into these ponds or into these raceways or whatever it might be, and that water is going to leave as effluent, well, of course, there's a lot of nutrients built up in those feeds and as it's washed out. So that's kind of their big concern, is preserving the natural waterways and making sure that effluent is clean enough and not any worse than kind of the way it would have been even had your operation not been there. Anybody know what NIMBY is?
Not in my backyard.
Not in my backyard. You hear it a lot. I think that was, I don't hit too much into it, but I think that was part of the wetlands thing and why people got in trouble. I think there was huge heartache or huge problems between neighbors, and even if you're doing everything kind of every bit by the book how you should be, but you're feuding with your neighbors who are right beside you, and all of a sudden they decide to call Johnny Law or U.S. Fish and Wildlife, whoever else, you know, kind of staying on people's good sides, even if you're doing everything correctly, can still be a huge headache and takes you away from what you should be doing, and that's focusing on growing your fish so you can get them to market as quickly as possible. But that is your NIMBY, your net, not in my backyard, which hits on everything. This isn't an aquaculture thing. This is kindly a world thing. It can be anything from my neighbor's got all the junk in his backyard and I can see it from my kitchen window and I hate it and I want him to do something about it, to things like farming and maybe they don't necessarily believe in it. So just good relationships with those who are around you to make sure that, you know, they understand kind of what you're doing. You know, you don't have to be buddy-buddy and share your business plan with them, but you do want to at least make sure that you're kind of in good networking with them. You have the FDA HACCP plans that was already mentioned. Anytime they alter a seafood product, if you're looking at something like saltwater shrimp, I think it was, we got a couple people here who are already growing, Mr. Beatty. If you just pull the heads off your shrimp, you don't do anything else, all you do is pull the heads off, that has to be done in a HACCP approved facility. You know, you're not cutting them up, you're not filleting your fish all fancy, all it is pulling the heads off of them. You got to do it in an FDA HACCP approved facility. Once again, the reason why it's really, really expensive. So you'll definitely learn about that. And then I did put, there's a little caveat there that we can talk about later on ways you can at least a little bit deal with kind of getting, not getting around, but dealing with the HACCP approved plans. Starting January 1st, everybody who's interested in aquaponics wants to know part of the reason that they're doing this is so that they are, I need to speed it up a little bit. You've got VFDs. If you're here for the OAA beginner workshop, this is not anyone who grows any other type of agriculture product, feeding your livestock and everything else. Antibiotics is a huge thing. So now you got to have VFD protocols set up so that you're going through and buying feed that might have any antibiotics into it. Has to go directly through a veterinarian now, whereas before January 1st, 2017, you could buy it directly from the feed mill. So if, heaven forbid, your fish do get sick and that is the last thing, it's either antibiotic feed or I'm losing absolutely everything and I have to start completely over, it's, you know, nobody wants to deal with the antibiotics. They're expensive and we don't want to deal with them, but sometimes it's a last straw. You do have to go through a veterinarian as of January 1st now. Of course, you got to deal with SHRAC, dealing with the Lacey Act. There is a SHRAC extension publication that gets a lot more in-depth into the Lacey Act, as well as examples. You know, if a farmer A does this and farmer B does that and I'm shipping my fish to him, can I fall under the Lacey Act, yes or no, and what constitutes whether or not someone would fall in? So if you are happen to look for interstate transportation, those are one of the avenues you want to do is to visit that website and kind of see what it is, what might make you fall under it, and what you got to do to prevent and keep yourself from being in that situation. I'm going to let Jenny Blackburn talk most about this because I don't know a lot about the produce sides of things or the horticulture sides of things, but you do have the Food Safety Modernization Act that the final rules just came out, and I guess that does. It starts off, this little diagram I just found on the FDA's website, but it was, you know, do you grow or hold produce vegetables? Well, yeah, a lot of us are because we're going to do aquaponics. Is this for personal consumption? Yes, some of you don't have to worry about that, but if you're going to sell it, they'll say, is it consumed raw? Well, a lot of it is. A lot of it's not value added. Then you look at, yeah, I'll sell all or some of it, and then it determines, you know, how much are you selling? Is this $25,000 or less? If not, or if you grow less than the $25,000, you're often exempt from the produce rule, but if you're growing more than that, you'll have to keep going and answer a bunch of other questions that you don't want to have to deal with, but these are things that rules are set in place through the FDA, and say as they say, or do as they say, I guess, in order to stay within the laws. Do you need a partner? A lot of you guys will get to know each other quite well over the next 12 months and figure it out. Some of you already picked out your partners by default. But on your own, of course, means less hands together, unless this is sort of like in a co-op atmosphere, because then you're all going to kind of hopefully benefit. But you want to match with something that's beneficial. If you know the business but don't have a clue about aquaculture, at some point it might make sense. Not a necessity, but it can certainly, as long as y'all are working in a cohesive environment and all get along to the best that you can, it can certainly speed up kind of how well your business is going to do if you have people that complement yourself. There are negatives to everything. I think Hannah's actually given a talk at the co-op website on the advantages and disadvantages of a co-op, and so she'll get a lot further into it. But those are things to at least consider, and some of y'all might even meet each other here and determine, I have a better strength in this than that. But it's just things to consider. How are you going to get it to market? We really don't have that many brokers, per se, as a lot of these other agriculture products. Aquaculture is super tiny here. You saw all the data earlier from Bill, so won't get it too far into it. But a lot of people, I think I'd been here a couple weeks, I got a phone call from somebody in Ohio. They had grown 5,000 pounds of tilapia. They were ready to come out in 2 weeks, but they had not even crossed their mind that they needed to sell those products, where they were going to sell them. So I got the phone call and said, where can I sell these fish? They're coming out in 2 weeks and they need to go. Can you help me out here? I need to sell them. I didn't ask how much she needed to sell them for or anything. We just ended up getting her product sold, but that stuff needs to be thought about a long time before, because they were in Enroll, Ohio, nobody anywhere really close to them. A lot of people don't have a truck and are willing to go to somebody that they've never even met before, never got a phone call, just a cold call and said, hey, can you come buy my product? Most people, even if they're willing or even if they have the trucks and the tools and the time to devote to it, if they don't know you, it's going to be hard-pressed for them to drive all the way out to where you are, pick up your product, and send you on your way. It just very rarely happens. That's why people do talk a lot about, on ice or selling to somebody else that might can sell, drive it straight into New York, Toronto, things of that nature with some of your other species. That's a hard thing to do, especially as we mentioned, we don't really have a processor here. We're really at a bind, but there's a lot of upsides to every downside too to consider at least. Of course, as I mentioned, you can sell right at the farm. She was, and that is both a blessing and a curse. If you're somewhere where you already have your land, you already have a farm, you're in a rural area, that's real nice, but someone from Columbus isn't necessarily going to drive an hour and a half to your farm just to get up a couple fillets. It doesn't make sense for them to do that. So your land is a lot cheaper and you're out where your farm's already located, but it's really tough to get somebody all the way out to your farm, especially if they don't have another reason to come out that direction. So there's pros and cons to whether you somehow get it into the farmers markets, whether it's with these insulated bins right here to help keep it at the proper temperature, salt your tanks and add plenty of good oxygen to it, or things like farmers markets directly on ice. Do you need a business plan? Pretty much, if you're trying to make a business and you've never really done one before, that answer is probably yes. That's why we're going to have the business team spend the whole year working with y'all to help develop one, to help you be as close to successful as possible. If you are going after funds because you don't have the capital to fund yourself, it definitely helps with the chances of funding. If you send something that is two or three pages and this is just a brief synopsis, yeah, that's fine if you're doing an investor pitch, but if you're truly trying to get the full in-depth detail about the business, it's really kind of second to none as far as the chances for success. Even if you are self-funded, a lot of people have the wheels just turning constantly in their head about what they're going to do with their business. And they all sound fantastic, and then you put it on a piece of paper, and not everything that looks good on paper, of course, actually works out in reality. But it does help you to chronologicalize, kind of figure out what's going on in the steps you need to take to help improve your successes. And then there are aquaculture and aquaponic business plans that you can go through that does lead you step by step. Minnesota, it's agplan.umn.edu. Y'all get the information later. But they do a great free agriculture business plan. You can adopt it into the aquaculture side of things. And then there's plenty of, that's Dr. Engel, she's the aquaculture economist that will be here June or July, but she'll definitely be here to help give some pointers and things of that nature too. On your business plan side of things, thinking about how healthy the crop is. Does it look pretty good? If you're a lender, it's a little easier to tell that this farmer's asking for, if they're asking for money for next year or 2 or 3 years down the road, they seem to have it figured out and know what in the heck they're doing, right? They came up, they look healthy, they look ready to go. As Bill mentioned, can anyone tell me how healthy these ponds are? This is why a lot of your lenders have a very tough time. You might just have booming production in here. It might be the most pounds you've ever pulled out of ponds. They might be the biggest, most beautiful fish you've ever seen. But unless they happen to be there on harvest day when you're pulling fish out, your lenders have no idea, especially in here. The economist that I talked about, I think I'm about out of time, but the economist that I talked about, she did a lot of work with working with the lenders in Arkansas. Totally different animal down there. They've got over 30,000 water acres just devoted to aquaculture. If you are a lender in that area and you've been a lender in that area for any amount of time and you've seen how well that your farming, that your fish farmers have done, especially if you're in some of these small communities where that's all they have are these giant fish farms, yeah, you're a little bit more likely to go ahead and lend money when you know that these people know what they're doing, even though you can't see what's underneath this water. Here in Ohio, people have no clue. That's why Bill talked about sometimes you might can get an RAS system because you can really see the fish and see how well they're doing. A pond system is a totally different animal altogether. But nobody really has an idea. Yeah, we know that there's no dead fish sitting around the bank right here. But all that lender might know, there could be 10 fish out there. There could be, I think that's like a 25-acre goldfish pond. So, I mean, there might be hundreds of millions of pounds on that farm, but they have no idea being around in this area. So what's next? You see a lot of, you know, if you follow kind of along the path, you kind of figure out all these questions, things that you need to know, answering all of your questions. You know that your location, know what types of permits you need. This stuff doesn't happen overnight, but we do help shorten the learning curve and help you answer these questions along your way. What's next? I am OSU Extension, so long after Aquaculture Boot Camp, as you have your questions, both bug Bill and bug myself as well. Be glad to help any questions that we can. But I'll be here for the next 11 modules, too, to help you guys out. But I think I probably have about 4 seconds if anyone has questions. If not, I can talk to you afterwards. So we're going to get started. Who's ready to jump out now? We've heard a lot of good information today, and I think from each presentation yet, we've heard business plan. That's why I'm here. Again, I'm a Small Business Development Center counselor. SBDCs are nationwide. We're funded mostly by the SBA, among other things. But Region 7, which is the region you're in now, is here in southern Ohio. There's about 14 SBDCs throughout the state of Ohio, so you folks that are up north, there are several up in the Cleveland area and Youngstown area, and folks over near Dayton and Cincinnati, there's several over there as well. We all do the same thing. We're fortunate here at the South Centers because I think maybe Paul and Matt may have talked about it a little bit more. Tom didn't really go into detail, but we have multiple programs here at the South Centers that other SBDCs don't have that that available, that we can kind of bounce ideas off of, bring specialists in just like we're doing here, work together for this type of a business as well as other horticulture type things, soil and water type things, energy type things. We have all that here as well as I mentioned before, the Cooperative Development Center that we do a lot of different projects with. As well as the center that is right beside us, it's actually a business incubator.
It's called the Endeavor Center, and we're an award-winning incubator for businesses here in Southern Ohio to help get businesses started and help share those costs that some businesses have. Also, Jordan's passing around my business card. I saw some of you jotting down my information. That's going to be very important, because what we're going to do, and the kind of the purpose of my job for you all, is to help you in developing that business plan. Whether you've got a business already, whether you're not going to start a business just yet, but you've got all these ideas going around, we're going to go through kind of how to do that and how we as a group are going to do that, because I just think that's very important to do. It helps you get all these ideas on paper and then bring that to fruition. So again, we're going to talk a little bit how we, the SBDC, can help you. The business planning outline, for those of you that have never maybe looked at doing a business plan, the importance of those financial projections that are kind of difficult to come up with sometimes for this type of a system. Funding your small business, I do have some slides on different options for you. I know that's a question that always comes up in talks that I've done the past 7 or 8 years. Getting started on our business plan, and then different websites of interest and Q&A. So again, who we are as a small business development center. Most of us, you have to be a certified business advisor to be an SBDC counselor. It's training that we go through at the University of Toledo. And many of which of us counselors have or have previously owned our own business. I myself have a couple businesses. My parents have been in retail as well as farming for over 40 years. And so I'm right there with you. From startup to hiring employees to firing employees to all the different marketing aspects of business to management, I've gone through it. There were some LLC questions before, the initial startup and the you know what it takes. I can help you do all that. You're free to go to an attorney, go to an accountant, pay them $400 or $500. I can do it. Our services are free of charge. I'm sorry? Yes, our services are free of charge. SBDC services are free of charge. Your tax dollars pay for it. So that's why we're here. So like you say, no cost, and I've got underlined there kind of the things we're going to focus on, but we do all those other things as well as SBDC counselors. So developing your business plan. That business plan serves as a roadmap, okay? Again, you've got these ideas. You've probably gained some ideas today. I myself have kind of heard some things and been like, man, maybe I could go home and try that on my little farm that we've got. You know, maybe I could do this or that or whatever. Call me crazy, right? But it's going to be who, what, when, where, and how. How's it going to happen, okay? That's essentially what that business plan is going to answer. The five things, I'm a former lender. Prior to coming here to Ohio State, I worked for Farm Credit Services in Mid-America. I was a lender for them, opened an office, worked there for several years, and then my alma mater came calling and I had to come work for the Buckeyes. But lenders focus on these five things. Okay, I actually just watched a video a couple days ago on this specific, and I took down very good notes because things change. The lending world changes a little bit. And for all practices, for ag practices, ultimately, this is what they're focusing on. Again, I appreciate you taking notes. You can do it. If that's how you like to do it and how you learn, that's great. Something we didn't mention, all this will be available on the website. Okay? So, operation and overview. That's one thing and one of the main things they need to see. Basics of your operation, who the owners are, what's your mission, what's your objectives. Okay, if you don't have those questions answered in your business plan, you're missing something. Identify your strengths and your weaknesses. Everybody has them. Okay, we've all got weaknesses. We've all got strengths. I was talking to a couple earlier. You know, there's things that one excels at, something that the other one excels at. They work together as a good team. I see a lot of teams here today. That's great. Include your balance sheet. Banks love these. Okay, again, assets and liabilities are what you own compared to what you owe. Do this every December 31st, even if you don't have a business. This should be something you should be doing anyways. Go over your assets, your liabilities, check out what that net worth is. It should be increasing. If it's not, why not? Is there a problem? Have you purchased something? What's the issue? Include that budget. That'll keep you on budget, keep you on point. go through prior to getting started and figure out what this thing's going to cost. I think it was Matt that mentioned somebody was raising tilapia or raising some type of fish, and they called him 2 weeks or 2 months into his position and said, hey, how can I get rid of these things? That's got to be what you figure out first. What's your market first? One of the things we'll figure out first. And then include those goals. Write them down. I've heard that a couple times today. Research does show if written down, you're more than likely to achieve those goals. So write them down, even if they're way out there, okay? Even if it's broad goals, you know, way out there, hey, I want to do this. This is why, this is how I'm going to get there. Write it down. Someday, you never know, you'll reach it. So that business plan is going to consist of several sections. Really, the five main sections, though, that a lender really focuses on is that executive summary. Me as a lender, I didn't have time to read through. I've seen some business plans that are literally 80, 90 pages, okay? Lots of pictures, but 80, 90 pages for this type of a industry. I don't have time to do that. I focus on an executive summary, a couple pages, okay? But then you go more in detail, business description, and then each section, money, marketing, and management. We're going to go through all of those and what they include. Executive summary, again, brief overview of the business. We just talked about that. It's read first. It's sometimes easier, however, if it's done last. You get everything done, and then you go through and you summarize everything. Why is it going to succeed? If you're seeking financing, show how much, when it's needed, and for what, and from where. Kind of do a source and use statement, okay? I have several of those that you could use as a template. You document everything, where it's coming from, what it's going for. It helps with collateral when it comes to a lender. You know, lenders are in business to make money, not to necessarily give it away and lose money. They have nice buildings and nice things because they make money, right? So they want to make sure that they're secured, so they need collateral. What's your plans? Why does the company exist? What need does the company fill? We've heard several different options today on different things that, and markets that are available out there. What's the status of the business? Are you a startup, or are you purchasing, or are you existing? What's the current state of the industry, characteristics and trends? It's a growing business. It's booming. We've got a full room of people that are raring and ready, right? What's the product or service? Tons of products out there, and we have a bunch of now. We've done this a couple times, as Han Ping talked about, on the more focused aquaculture side. Now we're going to throw in a whole other line item doing aquaponics, okay? And we just heard about and saw the options there. And then what's the industry? Who are you selling to? Farmers markets are big these days, but do you just want to get rid of it and be done with it? Okay, wholesale, retail. Into marketing. Christy was here earlier. She's kind of our marketing guru. She's going to help us on this section. But, you know, who's your target customer? What age, income level? Where are you selling it? What's your competitive advantage? Why are you better than all the other people in the room? Okay, have you thought about that? If everybody else is doing the same thing, why are they going to buy from you? How are you going to position yourself? Are you the best value, the highest quality, cheapest, most convenient? All things you got to think out. What are the four P's? Product, place, price, and promotion. And then how are you going to market yourselves? I think we heard about how if you're an hour and a half away, if you're not right near a city, you know, how are you going to market what you have available? Management, that's you guys, right? Sometimes people leave this out, but, you know, again, I work with coffee shops to garages to tire shops to retail businesses to landscape companies, everything. We work with all businesses, right? They leave out, like, what's their qualifications? Give me a resume. Put it in there. Show me what experience you have. Show that you've been in a class like this. You've done tons of all this research and why you feel that you are capable of doing this. Who's responsible for what? How does the decision-making process flow? What skills do they need to possess? Who are you going to hire if you're going to hire anyone? Is it going to be a family-based business? How are you going to manage risk? I heard someone, I think we've changed seats a little bit here, ask about insurance. Who was it? Was it back here? Insurance. So I don't know if Bill's gone now, so I can talk about Bill a little bit. I don't know if he went into great detail on that, But insurance for this industry, it's a toughie, okay? It's growing, and we're trying to change that, and we're trying to educate. Same with lenders. It's a toughie. We're trying to educate, trying to make it not so tough. But he covered how you can, with you've got a farm, you can show liability coverage. But if you've got a traditional farming operation, row crops, cattle, hogs, whatever, you can obviously crop insurance. You can, what's the percentage crop insurance or crop guys that you can insure out there in the field? Up to 80%? Am I right? You can't do that with this. So it becomes a very dangerous investment for a lender, because there's, what's the insurance? Okay, power outages, we've talked about it, all the different things. So how are you going to manage that risk? All right, there's ways to do it, but you just got to think about it, maybe a little bit more than the traditional farming operations, okay? And then what professional support do you have behind you? Who you got in your, on your side of the court, in your corner? Accountants, attorneys, insurance agents, me, extension agents, specialists, okay? You got us. And then this part I like, right? The money side. Five main areas, again, I'm based on five because it's what we can remember, okay? Five main areas that lenders focus on. First and foremost, it always has been, always will be, your credit score. Who knows their credit score off the top of their head? Great. 700 preferable. If you got over 700, you can probably borrow money, okay? No matter what you're doing, they're probably going to talk to you. If you got below 600, let's work on that credit before going any farther. And we can help you with that. We got ways to do that. A personal financial statement. Your personal financial statement. Again, assets and liabilities. What's your debt to income ratio? Banks like below 36% to lend you money. Okay? They like you to stay under that. Available collateral. I talked about it before. What do you have? I've talked to a ton of people. Great people. Man, I want to do this. I'm passionate about starting this business. It might be the best idea. I'm like, wow, you've got an idea. What do you have? Ooh, I don't have anything. Got to have collateral. Got to have something that they can borrow, that you can borrow against. Cash contribution. What's your cash? What's your skin in the game? What are you going to lose? Don't put it all on the bank's back. What are you going to lose? How much money can you put down? And then, of course, the business plan, as we talked about, that's going to have those cash flow projections. They like 3 years, and I've got several good models that I can share with you. We can work together on to obtain and be able to generate those three-year projections that these lenders need.
On your one slide there on the percentage debt to income ratio,
is yep.
That outside of a mortgage, or is that what you're talking about?
Includes, because that mortgage, that home is going to also be an asset.
Yeah.
Okay, so it includes, that's a moving number, but if you stay below 36% debt to income ratio, you're good. Yep, you're good. Now remember, you're adding some, so say you add debt, you're adding assets too. So it's hopefully a 1-to-1, okay?
So is that debt minus assets, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay,
biggies on these financial projections. And again, we talked about before, kind of make that budget. What's your startup cost going to be? You know, we've talked to the mom and daughter couple here. You know, we've already got the land, already got the building plans, things like that, you know. What equipment's necessary? What permits are you going to need? What are the costs? What costs are we going to get? I was talking to somebody this week. They wanted to start very, very admirable deal. They wanted to start a nonprofit for a fallen soldier type of thing. And I started looking into it. 501c3s can get expensive, okay? Developing a nonprofit status with the IRS and all this. And I said, make sure you know all the costs before you jump in going, you know. He said, all right, so we're backing up. He was ready to go. We're going to make sure we got enough money before he jumps in. What are your fixed operating expenses? So rent, utilities, feed costs every month, insurance, labor. What are those going to be? Again, we have models to help you figure these. What income can be achieved with this new endeavor. Be conservative, okay? I've heard today, what's your goal? You know, are you just going to feed your family? Are you just going to feed your street? Are you going to feed your church? Are you going to feed your school, pass on the knowledge? Or are you going to become a millionaire? You know, who knows? Begin with industry averages. Those are out there. Those are available. You, probably within an hour, you could talk to Matt and figure out, okay, for this is what I want to do, this is what I want to raise, here's how big of a system, what can I make? What's the income I can get? What are the costs associated with that? I don't know, but I will help you figure it out. I'm not an aquaculture guru. I'm a business planning, financial projections. I've got all that information at my fingertips. Again, no business is exactly the same. No one person in here has exactly the same idea, has exactly the same assets and liabilities and things on their side. So they do all relate, though, okay? So we just need to work your specific system. Work with the current business owners in the industry, like Bill was talking about today, extension specialists, business development specialists, so on and so forth. Use these Excel models that I have available. We'll talk about those in a bit to assist in figuring all those costs. Generate those three-year financial projections. Funding your small business. This is a little slide I like. So self-financing. 15% is normally required as your skin in the game. So if you want to borrow $100,000, you need $15,000, okay, normally. The three F's, friends, families, and fools. Although it's normally frowned upon to mix business with family and friends, it is, if pitched and treated appropriately, it's not a bad idea. And I see some friends in the room, right, and family in the room in helping with these endeavors. Banks, hometown banks, traditional lending, and commercial lending. Again, farm credit. I talked to somebody earlier who's doing a USDA loan. They're all on board, but they're not on board millions of dollars yet. Okay, they want to see you get started. They want to see you prove yourself, and be upfront with them. Have a meeting with them initially. Hey, here's what our plan is. Here's what we want to do. How can you help? How can you be a part of this? There are, like I said, those government loan programs and partnership loan programs through USD, SBA, NRCS, FSA, Grow Now, Re-Energize Ohio. They've all got them, right? You work for them. Economic and Community Development Institute, ECDI, they've got some. Other organizations, you know, their gap lenders, microloans, community revolving loans. Check locally. I know all of them around here, but I don't know all of them that are available in your specific area. So check with your chambers, economic developments, SBDCs. See what's available for gap lending. It can help with that 15% down, okay? So you don't necessarily have to have that cash in your pocket. It can come from a gap lender, which is named just for that. It bridges that gap from what the banks can do to what you can do, and so on and so forth. Investors, we might have a couple in the room, who knows? Okay, but they're out there, people that may be passionate about this type of industry, but they don't know anything about it. They don't want to get their hands dirty, but they want in on it. Going public, crowdfunding, big deal these days, right? Once you get in, suppliers, buy now and pay later, okay? Discounts for quantity. Maybe you buy your feed, buy large amounts. We talked about it before. If you develop that co-op, purchasing co-op, you buy a lot, get 27% off. It's out there. It's available. Equity capital, money raised by business in exchange for share of ownership. Credit cards. This is something we're careful with. When I was a lender, wow, people have a lot of credit card debt. Be careful, but take advantage of those 0% rate options that are out there now, okay? There's good options for 12 months, even 24 months. I've seen 0% financing available. You just got to make sure you're making not only an interest payment, but principal payment as well. Amortize that out. And again, like I already talked about, check with those local chambers, economic development offices, and small business development centers for funding in your areas. So what's next? Well, this is why we're here. Together, we're going to develop a business plan. And I have, from several years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, I was looking, Laura Tu and I created, we took from Nick Rack and a couple other business plans that are out there, aquaculture-specific business plans that were out there, models, and created one. And I've got it. It's a Word document, and I'll share it. Okay. But for this purpose, and to make it easier on everyone involved, and this is where my business card comes in, and just information in general, I think Matt talked about already, we're going to go and log on to fishbizplan.org. It's a University of Minnesota program that is online, designed to help business owners. It's actually a commercial fishing business plan template, but it fits really nicely with what we're trying to do. It answers all the questions that need answered that I talked about before, but it also enables, it's an online module that enables you to allow me, to allow Matt, to allow Christy, to allow Jordan, whoever you want, access to your plan. And in doing so, you can be in Cleveland, and we can be in Piketon, and you can call me or email me or say whatever and say, man, I got a question on this, or hey, what do you think? And we can give feedback, and we can upload our own stuff. And I'm going to go into it here in a minute and show you how easy it is. It's an awesome program. And then when you're all done, when we're all done in December, you'll have a finished business plan that works for you. It's not a cookie cutter plan that we've created. It's something you've created to work for your system. And that's the goal. Even if you're not going to start a business, you'll always have that. Pie in the sky, dream it. Here's what I want to do. Let's do it. Let's do it together. Okay? So that's the plan. So I'm going to click on that, and then we'll come back to the last couple slides. I've already logged in. So let's see if it works. If it doesn't, I can log in again. So there it is. Here's what it looks like. And what I'll do, just for fun, I'm just going to start a new plan. Now what you do to log here, I'm going to log out. I'm going to show you. Here's what we do. So here's the front page, okay? When you log on to that, fishbizplan.org, that's something you will want to write down. You'll come up with this page, okay? So you enter your email account. Whoops. And you sign in. And then you won't have ABC2 Traditional or ABC Direct Marketing. I'm going to show you the difference of those two. You'll have nothing. And so you'll just be able to start a new plan. So these are what you can choose from, but for giggles, I'm going to go and show you. When you start a new plan, you've got that to choose from, fishing traditional or fishing direct marketing. It's just as it says. Direct marketing is a little bit more marketing intensive. It's got more sections per marketing. Christy loves it because it goes over everything she is going to go over. Personally, I think it's a little much, but if you are really focused on the marketing aspect of your business, and I'll show you the difference between the two. I think the traditional is enough. So this is the traditional. So let's view the plan. You see here in the left-hand column all the different sections that we talked about before that are included in a business plan, right? And down here in the bottom, it gives you questions to answer. Okay. Again, this is based more on a commercial fishing operation. So this is where the business plan that I developed with Laura 2, the business plan model that I developed with Laura 2 in a Word document, I'm going to pass that on to you because it has everything specific to aquaculture and aquaponics. So you can take that in another screen, copy and paste it, throw it over into this document here, which I'll show you. Let's just imagine that I'm in a Word document, copy, paste, paste, and there you go. And you can just start typing away. and answering those questions. Some of the stuff that we created that's on that Word document actually has industry data. Now, again, it was created back with 2010 data. There may be even updated data from that, but it gives you a good start. And in my opinion, in my mind, it gives you fillers for either those investors, economic developments, financial institutions, just knowledge for yourselves that kind of gets you started and gets you thinking on a business side of things. So again, I'll share all that with you. You can use it as you see fit and also add any information you already have. Let's see. Now, where I come in is you go into reviewers. So when you start a new plan, you name that plan, whatever you want to name it. I would name it my business name if you have one. If you don't have one, think of something fun. But you click on reviewers, and you type in my email address and anyone else that you want to be able to have access. You can have us be able to comment only or comment and edit. I would advise you to comment and edit. I'm not going to ruin your plan, but there might be something that I can edit for you. We could give it to our office assistants to edit for you grammatically, spelling, all of that. We do a ton of grant work and things like that, that they're able to do work like that and love to do that kind of thing. So, but that's up to you. Yes, sir. I would assume so. I don't know if it is exactly like Word that does that, but I would assume so that it's... If it doesn't, something that I usually do, if it doesn't do that, is I'll highlight it, like in yellow, or maybe there's a question that I'll want to ask. I'll highlight it, so then you can look, and you can look down through pretty quickly and see what has been done, what question is being, and you can do all that with this program. Everybody got it? Okay. Does everyone, I should have asked, but I know we kind of had it as a question as part of the application process. Does everybody have access to a computer, to internet? If you don't, we'll work with you. We can figure something else out. We're in Southern Ohio. Nothing against Southern Ohio. I'm from Southern Ohio. I live 20 miles away, but... Well, there's several people that don't have internet access, don't even have a computer. We've done a lot of longhand stuff with them. So there are also government. Yeah, you're right. But there's libraries that you can go to. There's options. So I'm just. If you already have it, and that's not going to be a barrier, perfect. Have I missed anything on this slide? A lot of words. I don't think so. The one thing I did want to mention up top, if you already have started one like you saw there, and I'm sure there are some people in here that have a business plan developed, right? Yeah, a couple, hopefully not a whole bunch. Okay, if you do, great. What we can do is either send that to me or populate that into this model. They've all got sections, so go to each of those sections. Populate it in. It might take you a little bit of time, but then you'll have it, and it'll be done, and it'll be online. That's the other cool thing. It's always on fishplan.org. There you go. Here's your websites of interest, money websites of interest. These are confirmed, guys. All of these have monies available. So, again, this will be available to you. But you just kind of got to work at it, look at it, see what's available out there. Again, ones that I have seen really work for this purpose, USDA, they kind of have to, believe it or not. I mean, really, how many people came last year to the OAA conference? I had a USDA speaker there, Frankie Stice Scott. I mean, that's what she said. She's like, we kind of have to do this. You know, we have to lend you money. But they can choose how much. And then on the bottom there, if you're in this southern region, These are all gap lenders that are available in this area. SOA CDF is the only grant program out there. I took my grant slide off. I used to have a grant slide. Grants are tough, guys, unless you're educational institutions. You might get lucky, right? Yeah, you might get lucky. I gave my last one away yesterday. I'm sorry. Right.
Franklin Gardens just got one this year.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, they're out there, but for personal operations, they're tough, guys. They're tough. Community organizations, municipalities, schools, that's a lot easier, okay? And then these are our informative websites of interest. We're going to shove those down your throat a lot, I know, but in business, you're going to become very familiar. One, Secretary of State, that's where you file your business, okay? Just to answer whoever the LLC question was, $99, okay? I'm not an attorney, but the LLC separates your personal assets from your business, okay? So if something were to happen, they can't come after your house, they can't come after your retirement, all right? I've got two LLCs myself. So it's easy. You can do it as a sole owner. You can do it as a partnership. And it adds a couple hundred dollars when it comes tax time. It's not that difficult. Yes?
The LLC falls under corporate, so you have to watch your insurance. If you do take out an LLC, it's not under your personal insurance anymore.
That's correct. But you don't want it to be. But usually, I have this case. I'm with the same insurance company, and I get a kickback or whatever for having everything in-house. Right. So you can weigh all those options, too.
The outside ponds will give you a headache because it's water.
Yep.
And the insurance rate will go up quite a bit.
Correct. Yeah, I haven't seen personally, but we can find that out for sure. I could get a quote and see where that is. But I do know one of the businesses I do have is one of the highest insurance-related industries. And I liability-wise, million-dollar policy, umbrella policy, $600 a year, $650 a year. I mean, we're not talking a lot of money, you know, for that type of liability coverage that you must have. You got to have when you're in business. Any other questions or comments? That was short, sweet, and not very painful, right? Yes, sir.
Can we just take a quick look at your direct marketing plan?
Oh, yeah.
Since it's so different.
So different? What do you mean? What's different?
Well, you said there's a lot more or something.
Oh, you're talking about my Word document plan. Is that what you're saying? Is that what you mean? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, my bad. I did not do that, did I? Let's see. Yeah, let's just go back this way. Sorry about that. I flowed right by it. Okay, so the direct marketing. Sorry, yeah, gotcha. I don't think I can pull them up side by side, but as you go down here to the marketing section, you see market trends, market segments, target market, customers, customer service, competitive advantage, pricing, promotion, branding, trademarks, distribution, yada, 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 right? See all those different things. And then on the traditional, it still has a marketing section, but it's not as broad. So, again, you can look at those. Look at the definitions, but again, as you see, it doesn't even have customers in there. But it's got what your current markets are. You can have that information in there. So it's just up to you. It makes no difference to me. To my knowledge, you might get to a section and be like, that doesn't even pertain to me. Leave it blank. We'll work through that, condense it. No problem. And what it'll do when you're done, you can then create, populate, and have a nice plan, finished, done, when that lender asks for it. The one thing we didn't touch on, and I'll hit real quickly, I have financial projection models for cage aquaculture, aquaponics, pond aquaculture, and recirc aquaculture facilities. I'll be honest, and I hate this, but there's not a great aquaponics one out there. We're still kind of working to make that happen, and we can take this and populate it into one of these others. And I know that's what a lot of people are in here to do. The one thing I can click on this, and Matt, chime in anytime you want on this, but it's important. This one we found through actually the EPA, right, Matt?
Yep.
And to my understanding, it looks like you can put in what type of facility you have, and it's going to then generate these numbers, and then you can fill in all of your different expenses, all of your income, and then that will populate to your P&L. You fill in your fixed assets, and I believe this would be your it's available capital. So it's not as this is my worst model. I'll show you the other ones quickly. Let's do research. So this is from Purdue. Again, several years back. We also have one tied to that fishbizplan.org as well, right? That we can utilize. But yeah, as you see here, this is one where you enter data and then it spits information over into what the bank needs. Excuse me, this would be all of your fixed costs on a monthly basis, each month, so on and so forth. I've got old numbers in there from something, but you just populate those in as you see fit. This is something we usually do down the road just to touch. Let's get the word stuff in, work to the financial part, and then we'll work on this stuff together with Matt's help, Paul and Dean's help, guys that are industry-wide, that we can get those, where those industry standards kind of are. I heard a lot of questions back in the aquaponics, like, if I'm running this much of a system, how much can be expected? Those are things we got to work out. Anything? Anything else? I'm done. I'm looking forward to it. We've got a good group. If you need me, email, call. I think my cell's even on there. That's the easiest way to reach me. We cover 11 counties for Region 7, so I'm very rarely here in the office. But call my cell. I'd be happy to help you in any way I can, and go from there. Thanks, guys.
Well, I'm going to do site selection and acquiring land. I really can't tell you in 15 minutes everything you need to know about site selection and getting your land and getting started, but a whole lot of things have been covered today. What I'm really going to do is I've seen some people starting to pass out and everything already, so I'm going to tell you a few horror stories and all that kind of stuff and just give you a few ideas what's going on. When you start thinking about this process, one of the first things you have to think about is security. And this is just an older picture of our facility here. This is right here at Piketon. This is four-lane highway up here. There's two-lane road that goes, well, actually it's four-lane over here, access into the uranium enrichment plant. Behind us, thousands of people a day went through there, at time. They're looking at everything we do. And there's another little road down the backside back here. So basically, we're visible on three sides. Is it good or is it bad? Well, it's good advertisement. We got about a 4.5-acre reservoir back here in the corner when we started up in 91. We used to let people come in and fish, just, have a good time back there. We got, because of all of our access here and everybody seeing us, The first thing they did was steal all the CBs out of the tractors and trucks that we used. Then they started taking the tailgates off the trucks to sell those and use them on their trucks or whatever. We had some cages of fish down in the reservoir, and believe it or not, the cages of fish started to disappear. So security is one of these things you got to think about as you're going along. I'm not going to do this in 17 seconds, but we're going to go through it pretty quick too. So these are all, I don't know how familiar everybody is, but you can see these ponds from the main highway right here and the access road kind of left us open. Now we've got some gates up, we've got security cameras and things like that, so don't get any big ideas about stalking your place out of here. We'll probably catch up with you. And then biosecurity, they've already talked about a little bit. We'll just kind of bust on through that one too. This has actually been talked about a good bit already too, but just some of the other things. We take this as our harvest trailer. We pull up between those, actually there's 12 quarter acre ponds, 2 1-acre ponds. We've got it on a truck here. We went to a tractor eventually because it's not a graveled road all the way around. If you can have a graveled road up to your ponds, it makes things a whole lot easier. First shrimp harvest I ever went to was a new pond they'd built up on top of the hill. It rained the 3 days before. We had all the equipment on our truck to help them harvest. They drug us about halfway up the hill before we got completely stuck with the truck and the tractor. We carried everything else up the hill. And we got it done. We still got it done. We took a generator up for power and everything. But these are some things you want to kind of keep in mind as you go along. Utilities are always, everybody's mentioned this, I think we've heard this 2 or 3 times a day too, but you want to make sure that you've got a good electric service into your facilities. You're always going to have to run aerators, and it gets a lot bigger when you get into some of the recirculating systems and things. What we had here, this place was built as a commercial facility really, so all of our power that's coming in is 208. 220 is your normal home. Most things are run on 220. Most of the aerators and things are 220. 208 is more efficient, but it's usually for the bigger 1 horsepower and above motors, and 3-phase helps out with that too. Nobody needs an electrical lesson either, but the idea is think about these things ahead of time as we go all the way through. For natural gas, if you run generators or anything like that, natural gas is obviously the way to go. Right now in this area, I can't speak for everybody, but our natural gas is our cheapest option by far. We're way ahead of electricity or anything like that. Generators, natural gas, pretty much when you're hooked into that, you can run from now on. There's not a tree falls over the power line, shut your natural gas off. That doesn't happen very often. We lose power around here quite often. We've got backup generators for 3 different buildings, I think, or ways to back up our power. That's a pretty good thing to keep in mind. If you can get phone and internet service, you need to think about that too. Anybody that's getting into recirculating aquaculture systems, everybody's been saying RAS all day. I don't know if everybody picked up what that is or not, but that's a recirculating aquaculture system. You're reusing the water. I think Matt said a lot of times you'll get up to 1 pound of fish and 3 gallons of water. I've heard as high as 1 pound of fish and 1 gallon of water. If you get up to that level and anything goes wrong, within 15 minutes you've got to be there and have it fixed or these fish are going to start dying. Water, the other resource. If you're doing, say, aquaponics in your garage, you can probably get by with city water. You can treat for that chlorine and everything's in it. If you're looking at a raceway system, something like salmon or trout, you might be looking at 500 gallons a minute of water you need. Next month, during the workshop here, I'll be doing a presentation on system selection. We'll cover a whole lot more of that and the specifics of that kind of thing. We'll get into this next month altogether. That's pretty self-explanatory itself. If you're going to build ponds, you need soil that holds water. There's even ways around that. You can line a pond. The expenses just go up. The recirculating systems, like I said, they get way up. Generators, electricity, you're going to need some feed storage. Some of our feeds that we use, we have minimum orders of 2 tons. If we want a specific size of feed from Purina, we have to order 2 tons at a time, so you got to be able to store that somewhere that's going to keep. And that's as quick as I can do it. That was like 7 minutes. That's not bad at all. Any questions? Thank y'all.
All right, guys, so we don't have a whole lot left today. This is just something I wanted to talk to you guys about this month, just because this is really an introduction to a lot of what we plan on doing throughout our boot camp. So one of the aspects of our boot camp that we would like the students to be a part of is really what we would consider like a class project. So besides just the hands-on activities and work that you guys will be doing outside at the hatchery or in the aquaponics system, outside of just learning here in the classroom, we want you guys to be able to kind of monitor things and go through the process of what it would take to be a part of this system over a longer period of time. Because once you leave here, you know, the setup and the initial startup is one process, but to actually keep it going over a long period of time is a whole lot different. So we really want to be able to help with you, you know, get those things started for you. So when we talk about projects, you know, some of the main things that come to mind when we want to do or we want you guys to be a part of a project is something that's going to be a hands-on design. So we know that you guys are in here a lot. We don't want you to have to be in here any more than you want to be in here. We want to be able to have you guys outside, but unfortunately, there's not a whole lot to do in a pond in January and February. So, you know, we try and do a lot of the core things in here and then get you out there when we can. We want you guys to ideally be able to work in groups to collaborate and achieve a common goal. So if you have a project, you know, whether it's monitoring your water quality or monitoring your fish or in the aquaponics center monitoring your plants, things like that, you know, it's going to take more than just one of you working on it. So we want you guys to be able to work together. Chances are, you know, even if you have a business of your own, you don't have a business partner, you're going to have some people helping you or working for you. So working in groups is very ideal. We want to include multiple topics and skills. So just like I said, you know, even though you may enjoy aquaponics and you may want to do that versus an RAS system or a traditional aquaculture system, you still have fish and aquaponics. So, you know, we don't want to just have you guys go out to the aquaponics facility and learn about the plants and all of that stuff, because in a system of your own, yes, it's you know, great to have the plants and all of that, but at the end of the day, at some point in time, you have fish you have to harvest. So we want to make sure that you know all the steps and all the whole process of what it's going to take to be able to do that, not just one part of it. And then, like I said before, we want you guys to be able to work on this project throughout the year. So something that you can come back to, watch progress, and be able to monitor different avenues and different steps of what it takes. And then at the end of the day or at the end of the year, be able to do like a summary report of, you know, how it went, what you did right. Of course, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of things that we may do wrong. You know, we don't like to admit that we kill fish, but chances are it may happen. And then we want you guys to be able to choose something that, you know, you're comfortable with. So, like I said, not everybody enjoys the traditional aquaculture scene. They want to be able to do something more advanced like the aquaponics. That's the new up-and-coming thing. That's what a lot of people are interested in. I know Bill had asked before, and a lot of you guys are interested in the aquaponics, so we want you guys to be able to do something that you can utilize in your own facility or your own system once you leave here. So ideally, we came up with, you know, two ideas that we are considering projects. So the first one is more of the traditional aquaculture. And you guys won't be limited to these two. We kind of discussed over lunch, and there's going to be multiple options for you guys, but just keep in mind some of the things that you can do. So the first one is an aquaculture project, and the objective of this project would be to raise yellow perch to market size in an RAS system, or it may be in the pond outside. But like I said, right now, January, February, really, you know, most of March, there's not a lot to do in ponds outside. I mean, you can sit there and watch them, but there's not a whole lot going on. So the system that you would be using, we say RAS, for those of you that are very new, that's a recirculating aquaculture system. So some of the things you have to monitor and really identify up front is, you know, you guys will be using yellow perch, but in your own system, you have to identify what kind of fish you want to use, how many fish you need to put into your system. You know, you could start small, but ideally the more fish you have, the more profit you're going to have. Feed is a huge thing. A lot of people don't think too much about this. It's really an overlooked thing. You don't think about all the different kinds of feed out there. You know, what size feed do you need for the fish size that you have? The amount of feed that you'll need, brands of feed. You know, I didn't really know this until I worked at an fish facility up in West Virginia, or I guess say down in West Virginia. And I didn't really think about this until I walked into their storage room and saw all the different kinds of feed in there for one kind of fish. So it's kind of something that really gets overlooked. And then how often do you feed? You know, you don't want to feed your fish. I know when I first started working here, it was probably the most fun thing I could do was walk out to the aquaponics facility and feed the fish. And they went crazy every single time as if I have never fed them before. And I loved it. But ideally, you don't want a lot of food waste sitting on the bottom of your system. So you can only feed them so many times before they're not going to eat anymore. So that's something to keep in mind. Water quality is a huge, huge aspect of whether you do an aquaculture or an aquaponic system. Water quality is really, really important. So not only what do you monitor, such as pH or DO, but how often do you monitor that? You know, you don't have to do every single thing, every single parameter, every time. But ideally, you want to be able to do some things every day. You know, other things you may check once a week. So those are really important aspects that we want you guys to be aware of. Temperature, if you're dealing with yellow perch, is very different than if you're dealing with, you know, bluegill or largemouth bass or catfish. All those fish have to remain at a different temperature than maybe another. So your water temperature is extremely important. You don't want to stress your fish out. And then for this project in particular, when do you want to put fish in a pond? So you want to, you know, kind of realize your stocking date as well as your harvest date. So you don't want to harvest too early. You want to be able to give them enough time to grow to an optimum size. You know, and all of that depends on, you know, your market as well. So those are things that we really want to keep in mind for a traditional aquaculture project. So because there's not very many things to do in the ponds in January, February, really kind of March, we're going to be able to have other options for you guys to do until then. So the other side of things is an aquaponics project. So the objective of this project would be to construct a kind of a miniature aquaponics system. And we're going to plan on doing that through barrelponics systems. So I don't know how many of you guys have actually ever, maybe online, have seen a barrelponics system. Okay, so a good amount of you. So it's really just an aquaponics system, just like you would see in a greenhouse, but it's a little less expensive, a little smaller, and you actually use rain barrels to do it. So a lot of people will, kind of just like in this picture, have a tub. It's a half of a rain barrel that sits up top that holds your plants, and the one directly below it is a full barrel, and that holds your fish. So, you know, just like our aquaponic system out in the greenhouse that we had shown you, you know, you need a pump that pumps your water from the fish below up to your plants up top. And then you let that drain through your medium that you have your plants sitting in, and you have an outlet drain, and it drains straight back down towards your fish. So it's a very simplistic type of system, but it kind of does the same purpose that a full-size aquaponic system does, just on a smaller scale. So kind of the same questions that you need to know for aquaponics. You know, we always link the two together, aquaculture and aquaponics, because you kind of have both in everything you do with aquaponics. You still have your fish and your aquaculture just as well. So what kind of fish do you want, and how many do you need? If you have a smaller system, chances are you don't need as many fish. So we'll probably have you guys using the tilapia that we have in our system now, but you'll probably only have maybe five or so in a small system. But with that, you don't need to feed them near as much because you don't have as many fish. Something you have to consider for this that you don't for your aquaculture side of things is your plants. So that's a huge factor. You know, what do you want to grow? You know, and especially with different things that you grow, you know, you have different needs. So when do you, you know, put them in? If your system's inside, you don't have to worry about weather as much, but when do you harvest them? Our lettuce back there, we generally harvest every 40 or so days, but depending on, you know, what kind you have, that's different. Water quality is just as important in an aquaponic system as it is in an aquaculture system, because if your fish aren't doing well, chances are you have another aspect you have to worry about that, you know, may not be doing well either. So sowing seeds and harvest dates. So you're still harvesting something in an aquaponic system. It may not be hundreds of fish at a time, but you also have to worry about your plant side of things, which generally you harvest much more often than you would just your fish. So, you know, that's a big concern too. And then what materials do you need and what kind of design? So we will set up a design for you guys, and then we'll kind of follow that, but be very lenient about it. So we'll give you a general design, and then we'll kind of see where it goes. Now, something Han Ping and Bill Lynch, the OAA president, and I talked about at lunchtime was, besides these two projects, how many of you have a farm that is an established, fully functioning, either aquaculture or aquaponics facility that you know of that is close to your home? Raise a hand. How many do you know? So a good amount of you know of a place. So we want to be able to throw out an option for you guys that if you have a fully functioning facility by you guys, you know, it is an option that we could link up with a facility like that, and you could go do hands-on work at that facility and maybe have a smaller project or a setup there. That way, you know, you're in a place that is really ideally what you want to eventually get to. So Bill Lynch, you know, he deals with yellow perch, and he threw out the idea that anybody is welcome to go to his place at any point in time. And that would, you know, if you really just want to do the aquaculture traditional way, you know, he won't have much going until they get their fish up and moving in their ponds and things like that. But it's always an option. So if you don't have a place or don't know of a place, we have mentors in our OAA and ABC program, and that's one of the larger aspects of our program, is bringing in these outside mentors to be able to help you guys understand what it takes to have, you know, a functioning facility of your own. We want you guys to, you know, if that's where you want to be one day, we want to bring in the people that will help you get there the easiest, the quickest, and with the most knowledge that is available to you guys. So between now and our next workshop, Bill and Han Ping and I are going to kind of work on gathering a list of places that we can recommend to you that have mentors in our program. And when we say mentor, you know, it could be anywhere. It doesn't, they don't have to be a mentor in our program, realistically. If you go somewhere and it's a place by you guys that, you know, we don't have someone from that facility in our program, but you can still go there. If they're teaching you something that, you know, is beneficial to our program or an aquaculture aquaponics system that you guys eventually want to have one day, that's a mentor. So that's someone that is helping you get to where you want to be through the knowledge that they already have. So to us, that is beneficial at any point in time. So that, just keep these kind of options in mind. But I do want to say, you know, I know Bill asked this before, but if you had to choose one, not necessarily for a project now, but how many people would prefer the traditional aquaculture? So we still have a few. Okay, and then the rest kind of maybe in aquaponics. So we want, you know, we don't want to throw you guys in on an aquaponics project if you really don't have any desire to do the plant side of things or the aquaponics side of things, but we want you to be able to learn as much as you can and have as many options as possible. The only idea, you know, with being able to go to these other farms and use these other mentors is most likely it would require time on your part outside of ABC. So if you come here one Saturday out of the month, you know, and you're spending time here, you would have to go to that farm at some other time. Now, we can talk about it more over, you know, the next few weeks, and we may decide that if that, you know, is a viable option, then at the afternoon time when some people gather for pilot projects they may have here, we may say, you know, this is time that you guys can go ahead and leave. If you have a place that you, you know, can go and you have kind of a setup there, then you can go spend the time that you would have spent here there. So that is always an option, and that's just something that we want you guys to be able to have, is as many options as you can. We don't want you to feel like, you know, you're forced to do a project that doesn't really pertain to you. And we know that, you know, if that is something that you want to eventually have, is, you know, that business and that functioning facility, you know, there's really no better place to learn than at a facility that is functioning. You know, they started somewhere, and I'm sure it was the same place that you guys are starting now. So kind of keep that in mind. And that is the end of my presentation.